Thank you. Welcome to a joint meeting between the Board of Selectmen and the Warrant and Finance Committee. Today's agenda is to go over all the departments for the budget for the 2017-2018 budget year. So we've got them broken down into, is it 20-minute, 15-minute increments? 20-minute increments. And our first one is the transfer station. So.
And that's the last three pages in Department 105 in your books.
So.
I guess I'll start by asking if there's any particular questions. Yes, Will.
Mr. Mann, I was told when I moved here that you ran one of the best departments in the town, and I can personally agree with that. Congratulations, sir.
Well, thank you. I appreciate that.
My question is, you're very efficient, but I'm sure you keep abreast of national trends.
Yeah.
What could or should we be doing in terms of future in order to capture more recycling, perhaps, and capture more revenue from such an operation?
Because the more you capture, the more revenue you're going to get.
Volume, you mean.
And, yeah, and the problem is that the stagnation period across the country, as far as recycling rates, you know, it's like 34% nationwide. Last year we were 38%, so a little bit above, but you always could do better. Different towns have tried different things, pay-as-you-throw type thing, like they do in Sanford. Waterboro tried that at one time, but it didn't fly real well with the public. It's just another tax, basically, because you're paying for the bags that you're throwing away, but it does help to capture some of the recycling. So it's a tough question to answer as to really what you could do to try to increase it. Education's probably a good thing. You know, it could start in the school system, even. You know, as the kids get older, grow up. But there really isn't any solid answer as to what we could do. Just try to educate the public. Yes, Tom.
Bob, you have hazardous waste and 50991 here, $5,000. Does that mean we're going to have a hazardous waste day?
Hope so.
Okay. That's
if it flies, yes, we will have a hazardous waste day.
Okay, good.
It probably won't happen until this fall because it has to get passed first before we can even think about having one. But hopefully this fall or it might even go into next spring, but we will have one.
Does a hazardous waste day cost $5,000, or is that a line item included?
That's a number, because you don't know what you're going to get for hazardous waste. And actually, Pine Tree Waste is going to pay for half of our hazardous waste day.
Yeah.
In our contract with them.
So this is a guess, really, isn't
mm-hmm.
it?
Okay. Right, exactly. Right.
I didn't know whether.
And hopefully it's a guess. It's going to be money left in that account.
Thank you.
I have a question for Ms. Romney. Would you direct our committee anyway as to where the revenue from this department is located in the book?
All the revenues are in the very back section, year-to-date balances. You have your expense and your revenue reports and your reserve funds in that back section.
The transfer station is, are these numbered? No. Which page is the transfer station?
Close to the back of that section.
It's in the alphabetical order?
Third page from the back side of that section.
That's
a page number?
No, there's no page.
You look
number.
At page one of the revenue summary report. It's got a breakdown of the transfer station.
We're talking about this one. We're talking about that. It's all in the back.
Recycling and returns, $26,000
is what we've budgeted to bring in. Bob has brought in almost 23 to date.
What benefits do you give your workers, and is there any other item that you feel as though you need to improve your department as far as morale or anything of that sort? Because they do a very, very good job.
Yeah, well, you know what? Well, Michelle can probably tell you about what they get for benefits, like their insurance. Some have the insurance, some don't take the insurance. I don't know. I don't think morale is a problem. I haven't heard anything out in the general public, and I haven't heard anything from the guys about it. I think they're pretty happy.
All of the employees at the transfer station are eligible for healthcare and are eligible for Maine retirement. Not all of them take it, and that's their choice, but it is available to them. They're eligible for vacation benefits, and that's about all we have.
Longevity.
And the longevity benefits for anybody who's...
Do they also have the option of being in the Maine pension plan?
The Maine retirement, yes.
Yeah.
I have a question. I know several years ago, they talked about the transfer station being a self-sufficient entity. Is there any possibility of that happening in the future, or...
Well, it's something that could be looked into. I don't know, I think that the town of Shapley's looking into it, and I think that we could talk to other towns to see if it is a viable situation. Because it costs quite a bit to put it into originally, and what the payback period would be.
Right. And I know several years ago, they talked about doing that through the town process, and I, at that point, of course, it wasn't run as sufficient as this one is being run.
Mm-hmm.
And we didn't know how well it would work, but I didn't know if that was a foreseeable future anytime soon, or if that was just going to...
No, we haven't really discussed it, no. I don't think it's anything soon, but something could be brought up and talked about, definitely.
Thank you.
Tom?
Bob, do you have a figure for us for your energy expenditure cost up there? Electric bill?
That should be on the...
$2,900.
Go back two pages to the expense summary report.
Okay.
Transfer station 10540, it's all broken down there. So 50510, Michelle, is that right?
Yeah. 105?
Yeah. So he has budgeted $2,900 for electricity to date, well, a week ago.
1900.
He was under 60% of his expenditure, so there are very few costs at the transfer station. I think if we look at heating and electricity, they are probably the lowest use in the town, other than Mary Grant, who just basically has electricity for $15 a month. But
now the new phone service you all just got in, is that going to be part of that also, or no?
The phone service that we changed was just the actual provider in-house. I mean, they will, the BCN, you know, does own the line now, so it will switch over to Fairpoint, yes.
So it's a good chance that 700 might go down a little bit, or?
Yep, it should.
Okay, thank you.
Two questions. Roger, I assume, or I understand, is now an employee of the town, is that correct?
Mm-hmm.
And his line is in labor and line?
Yes.
Okay, also. The labor line, okay.
Yes.
And the other question I had was, I thought I overheard some discussion that the electricity budget was decreasing for this year, but it looks to me like from 14-15 or fiscal year 15 to the current request are all the same.
Is it for electricity, you say?
Yeah, the electricity line.
Did I
misunderstand what somebody said?
That's staying the same.
Right now, it's down. The usage is down this year.
Okay, so...
But it's not down enough that we should cut the budget and hope that it stays down. Do you know what I mean?
Okay,
we flatlined it, knowing that $2,900 always covers it. I mean, you're better off to have a little extra there than to make a drastic cut and it not be enough.
Yeah, that's fine. I just misunderstood. I thought that the...
We were just answering Tom's question about how much it was. And
All right, that's fine.
Any other questions?
I have one. Acton is listed on the Maine.gov site as mandatory recycling. And I know we have a sign up that says mandatory recycling, but we don't really
mandate
enforce it.
It's hard to enforce it, exactly.
It's really hard to enforce it, but... if we were to enforce it, what would it be? What would it look like if somebody...
Be a lot of hate and discontent. No, you know what? It's you can say stuff to people. I happened to be over there by the compactor the other day, and a guy dumped a bucket in there and had a bunch of glass in it. And I mentioned to him, I says, you know, the glass can go over next door. And a lot of times the response you get is like they roll their eyes at you and look at you like, yeah, right, okay. And you know what? A lot of people just throw it in their trash bag and black bag, and nobody ever knows the difference. And other than pulling the bag apart and looking at it and saying, you know, you should take that stuff over there. Next time they come in, are they going to do it? Probably not. It's a tough pull to try to say mandatory. And if you say mandatory and they don't do it, what are you, what's the ramification to them? You're going to tell them they can't come to the dump anymore? Or transfer station, excuse me?
No other towns do fines, you know, after third, fourth, fifth, you know, goes up. But like you said, it's really hard to...
Yeah, it is.
And you would probably need more manpower to be able to check all of those bags and follow up.
The public and different personalities, they tried that before and it was just...
It was a disaster.
Yeah.
It was a disaster.
It came to a point where they're, both sides were at each other's throats and housewives were afraid to go to the dump. It was just, you know...
Yeah, it's not nice.
What's the percentage that we do recycle?
I think last year was 38%. I don't know, I have a figure for this year because the report's just being made out and sent in. Then the state will determine the, what the rate is.
What's an average for a town our size?
Well, like I said, national average is 34%.
We're above that.
So we're above average.
You know, sometimes I think I talked to Clint Andrews over to Waterboro and I think they were at like 20%. So it varies pretty much across the state.
Do you have, excuse me, I'm sorry, go ahead. I think the one area where we might be able to improve or could improve is actually with our commercial haulers. If I'm not mistaken, our commercial haulers are coming in and just dumping loads into the bin right now. There was an effort a number of years ago to try to get them to separate.
We only have one commercial hauler.
Only one now?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, yeah.
Have over
and
the
he years. And he has got his permit from the town. He paid his fee. It was $250, I believe. And he does, when he comes in, he has the back of his truck loaded with the cardboard and the plastics and stuff. He does a pretty good job of separating, but there again, he picks up from people in town, and what do? They throw anything they want in their bag if they don't want to bother to recycle, and you don't know what's there. But
okay. I know that was an issue several years ago.
My last question. When we send our garbage up the turnpike, are those people happy with, they must do some sort of quality assurance on whether or not the garbage is capable of producing methane and electricity and all that? Are they pleased with the compact that these towns around here, including our own, have made as far as garbage compacting and recycling of the garbage?
Now you talk. I'm not sure what you're asking there, Will. Is the people that pick up our MSW trash?
Yes.
Are they happy with the product that they're getting?
Yes.
Is that what you're saying?
Yes.
Yeah, I haven't heard anything about it.
No complaints.
No? No.
Okay, that's all I have.
And just for the record and the people watching, because I did have a resident call me yesterday and ask me what happens to the compactor trash. Can you just let people know where that goes?
The compactor trash goes up to Westbrook. They dump it on the floor. They separate a lot of the stuff, and some of the stuff goes to up to PERC to be burnt for energy, and some of it goes to a landfill.
Okay.
What kind of revenues do you actually get from like the batteries and all the, you know, the stuff that the people actually can resell?
It's not,
probably not as high as energy is, though, but is there any still?
Well, a lot of the revenue stream, cardboard. It was down at $50 a ton. It's back up to 100. Number two, plastics. That can vary anywhere from $200 to $600 a ton. And same thing with newspapers. That's down low now. Our revenue is down this year because of the commodities are low. Newspapers and magazines are both at like $25 a ton. Batteries. We save up all our aluminum, all our electric cords. Electric cords, we sent out like 2,000 pounds of electric cords, and they were at a dollar, and now they're down to 40 cents. It all depends on the market.
What is your rough estimate, roughly? Do you think you guys can?
From all our revenue services?
Roughly.
From everything that we get?
Sure.
It's that number that you saw. It's like almost up to 23,000.
Good.
Okay. So we should be close to 26 this year.
Thank you.
Any other questions for Bob?
You mean I can go back to work now?
Yeah, anything else you want to add?
Keep up the good work.
All right. Thank you.
Stay warm.
Yeah. Thanks, Bob. Appreciate it.
All right, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Just to let y'all know, I'm sorry that I keep repeating myself, but we've got papers and we're reading.
Yeah.
People on the TV don't, so I just kind of like to throw that back out at you. It's not that I don't see it.
Mm-hmm.
It's just I want to make sure they understand it because we see it.
Mm-hmm. Nope. Okay. We're about 5 minutes ahead of schedule, which is good.
And just next up on the dock is Fire and Rescue. That's Department 104, which is Public Safety. They're at the very beginning. And I will note that the first page you see with each department is what the board has discussed on putting forward onto the warrant. The second page is what was requested from the department head. So there are some things that that will vary between what was initially requested and tentatively what the board wants to put forward.
Has that been discussed with the people making the initial request of departments? And I asked that question because last year we walked into a situation where we had departments with...
In the case of the fire chief, yes.
It has been discussed?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Yep.
And while we're waiting, if we're waiting...
In on time. Come right in, you're next on the docket.
Oh, look at that, perfect timing.
Yep. Yep.
Morning, everybody.
Good morning.
So, anyway, discussing the two pages that are in our book here. The first one is what we're putting forward, and the second pages were what you would put forward.
Correct.
So, go ahead and explain what you would like.
So, my initial proposal, I had increased, we'll just start at the top, I guess, I had increased the salary line by $37,888. And what that was representing was to put a third person on during the day, or use a per diem person during the day to have me as the third person on duty. There's a lot of meetings and trainings and things at the county level with all the area chiefs, with different agencies that we work with frequently that are really important to be at. Just because of the fact that that's how we get a lot of the things as far as working out mutual aid agreements, as far as working out responses, how we handle even things such as the other day we had a meeting on natural disasters and an incident management team. Plus also for me to attend schools on the new regulations, on inspection stuff, on code stuff, things like that. So it's hard for me to be able to go to those things as the second person on duty, because obviously I have to staff the ambulance. So that's why I had that increase in that line. So that's what we were trying to achieve, is be able to have that third person on duty so that I could, you know, attend all the meetings and schools and trainings and things of that nature. So going down the line, everything pretty much had stayed for the most part the same, with just a couple subtle increases. Let me see where my next increase was.
Employee benefits, that's part of the above.
What's that?
Employee benefits is the increase you're showing next. Most of that is probably associated with 501, your request for an additional person.
Yeah, correct. And we were going to do that with a per diem person, you know, as opposed to trying to do another full-time person and such. You know, we don't seem to have a lot of problem filling most of the shifts, so that way we don't have the costs that would come associated with a full-time employee.
How many do you actually have that are full-time?
Just myself and firefighter medic Sharon Jackson are the only two full-time.
And who do you have, how many do you actually have covering the station day and night?
We have two people on duty 24/7. And we've been working hard. We've been adding, hiring per diem medics as well to increase the level of paramedic service. We've been, every month we've been seeing about a 5% increase on the actual paramedic coverage. We also have advanced EMTs that can perform ALS skills, but they just can't do as much as like the paramedics can. The paramedics have a lot more tools in their toolbox they can utilize. But we've been, last month when I did the numbers, we were at the ALS level 97% of the month, and we were actually at the paramedic level almost, I believe it was 81.5% of the month, which is probably about a 10 to 15% increase over the last 6 months. And, you know, there's been more interest from other medics in other towns looking to work here per diem as well. So my goal, my ultimate goal, is come July 1st, we're trying to hire a couple more paramedics as well, firefighter paramedics. My goal is by July 1st to have 24/7 paramedic coverage. Over the last year, it was several thousand, I don't have the exact number, but it was several thousand dollars that we had paid out in paramedic intercept fees to Sanford for calls that we needed medics on. So that's been obviously decreasing with the addition of the medics we have, and at some point when we get to where we have 24/7 medic coverage, because we also get called to do intercepts, I'd like to entertain proposing to the town that we also go after a intercept fee, as a lot of towns do, so that when we get utilized for that service, we'll also get more revenue in return. So.
I have one more question. I know Jennifer might be able to answer. Mm-hmm. The propane. Do you guys share the propane contracts, or how does that work?
Yes, the bid that the town goes out with, the same company supplies to everybody.
Okay, so basically whatever you get.
Whatever, the same rate, yes.
Thank you.
Chief, can you tell us and the audience at home what the result will be if we're able to have all medic firefighters as far as rescue in our ambulance, and how that's going to increase as far as reimbursement from federal and insurance companies?
When we run at the paramedic level service, that you can charge and recover at a higher rate, as well as, again, the benefit of not having to call for intercepts and pay money out for the intercepts. So, but that's the biggest thing, is we would see an increase in the revenue return. Because
do you have any idea how much you are going to achieve by doing that sort of a process?
It's kind of a hard thing to tell, because we still don't even have really the true numbers on what we're getting in return from the insurance companies yet for the first year of the combined system.
Mm-hmm.
I think at this point, I think I'd say we're somewhere around the 50%, would you say?
The majority of most claims are being paid by insurance companies at around 35%. You have the rare cases of a car accident, you know, a call that was a result of a car accident. The auto insurance is typically pay 100%. As far as what's been billed to what we've actually received on the people that have insurance that have paid, it's right around 35% is, you know.
Are we sure that our company that's doing the billing is aware of the fact that we're upgrading our medical personnel?
That I don't know.
Chief, do you know?
That would be reflected just in the billing, that when they look at the call and they determine how they're billing it, that would be reflective in what they see on the paperwork going to them, I would imagine.
Right, because when you're uploading the call,
right,
the run sheet that she's getting.
Yeah, on the run sheet you have all the different check boxes, and it goes through the services that you provided during that call. And it goes through the whole series of,
okay.
Like,
and
if
then
it,
the billing company gets
right.
The run sheet.
Okay.
Yep.
Tom.
Several questions, Chief, and
sure.
And Michelle, you might want to get involved in this too. Revenue summary report. I'm looking down here, and we have a year-to-date net, and this is revenue, presumably, but it appears to be totally uncollected. $73,000 for ambulance. Oh, not, I'm sorry. That's $49,000 rescue services. Okay.
We have collected more than we budgeted for. We budgeted for $32,000 this year.
Okay.
In our other revenues, when we do the tax commitment, and we have received almost $50,000, probably by any electronic funds that have gone in the past week. I'm sure we're over $50,000 by now.
Okay. Now the ambulance reserve fund, what you're showing here is the $73,000 that you're showing is uncollected. Is that?
That is collected.
No, that's collected.
That is collected.
Yes, we didn't budget for that. We didn't budget that $73,000. That was the revenue that came in from the Ambulance Association.
Okay. All right. Okay.
So your revenues will show up. Your uncollected, if we've received more than we expected, it will show up as a negative on this report.
Okay. All right. All right. All right. So that is that's what the Ambulance Association ultimately turned over to the town, then, right?
Correct. And we are still getting little checks here and there for from the rescue billing company that were due to the Ambulance Association. And the Ambulance Association is signing it over to us, so we're putting those little tiny checks in, too.
Okay.
So.
All right. A couple other questions. Number of rescue runs, let's say year to date, and what do you project for the year?
So far year to date, total last year we represented about a 50-50 split on the call volumes, fire versus EMS. Last year we ended on just under 400 at like 386. This year we're already, I didn't look at the book when I was over there, but we're already at about a total of, I think it was around 145 calls so far this year, which is actually ahead of where we are last year. I think that this year coming up we're going to see another increase and probably be probably in the 425 to 450 call range. With the medics on, we're getting called a lot more to other towns to help. I don't have the breakdown of this year's calls the percentage of which were fire, which were EMS. I can tell you that it seems to me that we have an increase on the EMS side, especially because of our paramedic service. So I don't know the percentage. I don't have that answer for you.
I'm a little confused because you're using numbers of 400 and some odd, and I assume
right.
That's total number of calls.
Total number of calls, okay. For the fire.
And then, the 150 roughly that we're talking about is rescue calls.
No, the 150 is total. The 150 is about the total of calls we're at this year. Last year, we came in just under 400. I think this year we're going to be over 400.
This is a calendar year.
This is a calendar year I'm talking, yes.
Fiscal year.
Our calls are counted from January 1st to December 31st.
Okay, that's fine.
So this year we're already at about 145 calls total. I don't have the breakdown of how many were EMS, how many were fire on that.
Okay. So
did you estimate 50-50?
I actually think that it's heavier on the EMS side this year than last year.
That doesn't make any sense to me.
And so we're talking roughly 150 calls a year, and what percentage?
No, that's incorrect.
Okay, I'm sorry. I'm hearing numbers
today.
Of 450.
Today. Okay. For this year. Okay. To date this year, we're at about 150.
Calendar year.
Okay, all right. It's still early in the morning, and I haven't had this whole cup of coffee yet. One other question.
Sure.
What percentage of these calls are for out-of-town services, and roughly, do you have enough?
I think last year, we had about a third of our EMS calls were out-of-town calls. From last year. Again, I don't have all the numbers for this year to project.
Okay.
I've got two questions. One, what are you doing to promote our services to other towns in terms of being able to pick up for them, number one? And number two, are we really looking at the billing company? Because as a physician, I really have a hard time with billing companies. Are we making sure that they are billing correctly? And what is the percent of their retrieval? And if they aren't getting retrieval, are they billing the person to whom the services were rendered?
I think she wants to address this real quick.
Because we worked with it. So when it became one department, and this company, T.G. Higgins, that we use, they were half of the reason that we were able to consolidate and get the paperwork done as quickly as we could. So not going out to bid or not advertising it, we continued with them for 1 year. So we also don't have a full year's data.
Okay.
But remember, they also work on commission.
That was going
to
be in there.
So they are working diligently as a collections agency to bring that money in. You know, after we have a solid year's numbers, and certainly we can cross compare it based on how many calls to some other towns. But like I said, for now, remember, we had no administration. And this combination happened. So, I mean, they have certainly earned their keep to at least keep the town's business for a year until we can get more numbers. But
this is the same group that was working with the association.
Correct.
The association had. I would hope that we're really going to focus in on this, because they didn't bother to even bill anybody if they never got an answer.
Well, I'm going to assure you that there's more to the story with
okay,
that, and that there was some communication issues prior to, and they are, Michelle and I work with them both daily. We get our reports on time, the money comes in, the percentages are there. In the beginning, we had a couple of issues. We worked through them, and I mean, do you agree
things were very slow going at the beginning, getting everything switched over, and on the insurance end, them getting all the information switched over and the payments coming to us in a timely manner. I'm seeing things 100 times faster than I was a little over a year ago when we first started doing the runs. So it's only improving, and until we finish our contract, we really can't have it.
Understand.
You know.
Understand.
But we will compare it to other agencies when the time comes, just like any other contract that the town has.
I think there's better checks and balances in place now than there was in the past.
Excellent. Thank you.
And as far as promoting our service to other agencies, one of the things is that's nice about going to the meetings with all the other chiefs is we discuss all those things. That's another reason why it's important to go to those. But we also, every month, at the beginning of the month, prior to the first of the month, we give our schedule of when we have medics on duty and when we have advanced EMTs on duty to all the surrounding areas so that they know what we have for personnel on, so they know that if they need a medic, we have one they can call. So.
How many volunteers do you actually have at this point?
I think our total roster is about 37.
Do you have juniors? I knew that at one point
we have a couple juniors still, yep. And we're actually trying to work to get that program up and running, try to promote that program a little more too as well. I mean, a lot of the guys that we have now came from that program, so.
And what do they have to do to be a junior?
They just put an application in and they come down to see us, and then they attend a few of the monthly meetings, and then we decide based on their interaction and how they work with people if, you know, we're going to pursue them as a junior as well.
Age requirement?
I think it's 14.
Jim, you had a question?
My question's about the extra employee that you want to hire. You said what's driving this is that you're, you know, you'll have chief meetings or different obligations.
Correct.
Or training and so forth.
There's even actually been inspections that I've missed because I ended up going on a call and being stuck on a call too. Yeah.
Why couldn't you use a department vehicle I'm a former firefighter.
Right.
And that's what we used to do. If they're in-town inspections, you bring a radio and you take a vehicle with you.
I do that for the inspections. But if I'm the second person on duty and we have a medical call and the ambulance has to go on it, I have to go on it. And that's happened a couple times. Okay. And the meetings I'm referring to, most of them are York County Emergency Management, in that level. And yeah. The closest ones we have are, like, for instance, in Alfred at the EMA building. You know, so that's, you know, 20 minutes away.
Have you tried to put a number on? I would think you'd be able to figure out some type of number a year. Mm-hmm. Of how many of those meetings that you would have to attend.
I miss probably 4 to 6 meetings of different kinds a month.
4 to 6 meetings a month.
Yep.
Okay. And they're usually just a couple hours or a few hours, right?
It varies. Like the last one we had, there was tabletop exercises, which that turned out to be about 4 hours. We had an inspection training the other day. That was a full day. It varies.
So. Yeah. Now, what about mutual aid? Could mutual aid fill in, or could we get coverage just for those days instead of hiring?
I can get coverage for those days, and I don't have a problem bringing somebody in to cover me for those days. But again, that would also represent an increase in the budget as well. That's all.
Oh, so that would be.
And as far as using mutual aid to cover,
it would increase, but you're comparing it to a full-time employee.
Yeah. Well, we're not talking hiring a full-time employee. This will be a per diem employee, just filling the per diem hours. Correct. So. I'm not asking to hire another full-time employee. It's just covering per diem shifts. You know, and as far as using mutual aid as an option to cover when I go to meetings, it'd be kind of hard to ask a town to send their people over to not cover their town to cover mine because I'm in a meeting or something that their chief probably
needs
to get. It's
not like they physically send them over unless you get a call, you know? I mean, you wouldn't have to, or is that a policy within the department that you'd have?
What's that?
You wouldn't require the mutual aid unless you actually get a call, right? Mm. Or do you require that there are 2 firefighters on duty all the time?
We require 2 firefighter EMTs on duty at all time.
So that's a department policy, or is that?
Well, that's pretty much what the town had established through combining the departments in, you know, when they combined a year ago, is that they didn't want to have any less than 2 people on duty at a time to be able to get an ambulance out right away, you know, to an incident. Yeah. Or, you know, an engine to a fire, you know, vice versa.
Now, how does that work? If you get if you have a call come in,
yep.
Can you respond the ambulance with one person? And if there's another available EMT at home or something, can they leave from home and meet the ambulance, or do you have to have 2 leave from the firehouse?
Well, the problem is you can't count on people being available to come in from home.
Yeah.
And part of the big motivation why they combined to have the full-time staffing was that there were a lot of calls that were missed.
Right.
In the time that they've been full-time staffed, the department hasn't missed one call. And as far as you have to have the minimum of at least 2 people on the ambulance in order to provide care and transport. So we do get people that come from home as well, and I encourage that because a lot of times just having the extra set of hands, or if you have a critical patient, having the 2 people available to work in the back of the ambulance as well as having one to drive. So the minimum I feel comfortable with is having the 2 people. Even if they go mutual aid or they're out of town, we encourage the people to come to the station to cover while the ambulance is out of town or transporting. As well as if you go mutual aid with an engine, you know, we'll have people come by and cover the station as well as the crew that's out of town working, you know, vice versa. But
one proposal or think about that we did 2 years ago when we actually began looking into this issue was a proposal to pay people simply to stay at home or be available during shifts, not necessarily at the fire station, so that they would be available in the event that there was a call and you could count on them. That's kind of an intermediate way. That way, nobody's sitting around, but they are available to respond if necessary. It might be something worth looking into in this situation. Would kind of meet in the middle, would also go to towards subsidizing and supporting our volunteers who might like to volunteer for some of this stuff. And they may be able to do that at a considerably lower figure. Thank you. Just an idea I'm throwing
out.
Great
idea.
You know, on call, you know, paying people to be on call can be a good thing, but then you still have the issue of delayed responses, because for them to come from home, you know, 5, 10, 15 minutes to get to the station, to get the equipment to go, you know, 5, 10, 15 minutes to the other call, then you start looking at delayed responses of 15, 20 minutes to, you know, people where every minute can make a difference too, though. That's why we encourage the minimum of the two people on duty.
Well, if they're the ones, like what Tom's saying, wouldn't they have their gear with them and respond right to the scene?
Right, but how much fire can you put out with your personal vehicle? How many, you know, how much ambulance equipment do you have in your own car?
I'm not saying that, but someone would leave. There'd still be someone at the station who's going to leave with the truck, the vehicle. I get that, yeah. You know what I mean? And then, you hear what I'm saying?
I hear what you're saying, yeah.
Mr. Chair, I have one last question. It's perhaps not actually related to the budget that's been proposed, but to the new ambulance. Mm-hmm. You still have four bidders that have submitted bids to you, is that correct?
Correct, yep.
I just wanted to reassure myself that we're talking about all four of them have the basic, meet all the basic specifications that you had asked for.
Correct.
I was told that there's maybe one or two that have some sort of reputation that's less than luster. And my only request is that if that be the case, that I assume that your department will go ahead and contact people who have received vehicles from those questionable bidders and have evidence that their trucks are inferior to the one that you finally
Correct.
End up choosing.
Yep, absolutely, yep.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other questions for the chief on his budget? As you see, there was the two different sheets. There's a difference in, Michelle, what's the difference in the numbers?
The chief had initially requested almost 38,000 there for an extra full-time person, and that was removed. The capital improvement truck fund, he had initially requested $75,000, and that was brought down to 30. And he had initially requested $35,000 for gear, and we have discussed bringing that down to 31,500. Those are the major changes.
What was the second one, the 75K?
75,000 was brought down to 30.
And what category was that?
The capital improvement truck fund.
Chief. What was that last figure, Michelle? I'm sorry.
Gear.
It was 35,000, his initial request. That was brought down to 31,500.
Thank you.
Can you give us a quick synopsis? You got about 3 minutes left about 3 minutes left. On the SCBA turnout gear lease program.
Sure. So we're in a bit of a situation here. We have 15 sets of turnout gear, which are about to go out of what's considered their 10-year service life per the NFPA standards, which is the national standard for turnout gear, SCBA, things like that. We've got about 15 sets of gear that are going to reach their 10-year limit mark. I think it's by the end of June. So we were looking, I'd actually put in for 20 sets of turnout gear on the lease program to replace those 15 sets, and then that would also free up four or five more sets of gear that would be good for 4 or 5 years left to for the additional, considering knowing we're trying to hire three or four more firefighter medics to have gear to be able to put them in. So the life expectancy on turnout gear is 10 years. The life expectancy on SCBA is 15 years. So the company came in to do the flow testing on our SCBA, and it came to find out that out of the 15 sets of SCBA we have, that six of them are between the ages of 12 and 15 years old, and 9 of them are between the ages of 15 and 20 years old. It's hard to pinpoint exact dates, but they can ballpark it pretty accurately. The problem is, you know, again, the life expectancy per the industry standard is 15 years on SCBA. One of the SCBA failed, and the numbers based on the flow testing that they do on the packs, he had to do quite a bit of adjusting on every one of the packs, and they've reached the max on their adjustments, and they're predicting, the company's predicting that if we keep them another year, next year, pretty much every pack is going to need overhauling with the valving and things like that for the regulators, the secondary and the, you know, primary and secondary regulators. And the problem with that is, because they're so old, they've discontinued making those parts. So the only way that you can even replace, you can't just replace a part. You have to get the updated kits to replace the entire regulator assemblies as opposed to just parts, which is going to get very costly. Not to mention the fact that should something happen, even though we did do the proper testing and everything this year, again, it showed their borderline. If should something happen because of a SCBA failure in one of these packs that is over 15 years old, we're going to be held to the fire pretty heavy on that.
Was that a pun?
What's that?
Was that a pun?
Yeah. Yes. I didn't even mean to, but yes. So what I had proposed, I have two purposes of what I proposed. I proposed a lease program, which is a 5-year lease program. You put 10% down, and then your first payment isn't due until the anniversary of the lease signing. And what I proposed is that we get the 20 sets of gear, and then we get replace. I'd actually put in for 17 SCBA, 15 to replace the ones we have, but two more because with the new ambulance, we spec'd it with mounts so we can have air packs on it. Because a lot of times if we're on the way back from the hospital, we always have our turnout gear. You might get called to a fire where you could be first on scene and have to effect a rescue or something of that nature. So we proposed two additional packs to have on the ambulance as well. So what we're looking at was, find that sheet. So I worked with looked at a couple different lease companies, and one of them was offering an interest rate of 3.09%. And you would be looking at the total price for the 20 sets of gear and the 17 SCBA was just over $136,000. So we were looking at $13,000 down, and then it was going to be $26,000 a year, approximately, for the 5-year period. The thing is that also, the good part about this is that it also helps set us up for down the road for, you know, more stability. At the end of that 5 years, you've still got, you know, well, actually you'd have 4 years left on the turnout gear because the first year you make the down payment, so it's really like a 6-year plan. But you'd have 4 years to plan and put away, you know, in a capital fund for turnout gear, because you'd still have 4 more good years with that 20 sets, as well as with the SCBA, then you would have 9 years to put away and plan, you know, a capital fund to replace your SCBA down the road. And as long as we follow that model, you know, once we get the stuff and continue to put away for it, then that would really stabilize some of the major impacts that we would come to you with down the road, 5 years, 10 years down the road. So instead of 1 year saying, listen, we need $200,000 for gear and SCBA, you know, we would already have that in the fund, and all we'd have to do is come to you and say, hey, listen, we just this year would like to tap into this fund. It doesn't affect the tax rate. It helps you stabilize, you know, the long-term tax rate. Not to mention, one of the disqualifiers for getting grants is if you have, you know, half of your stuff or more still in service. If you come to a point where everything is coming to the end of its life cycle at the same time, you have a lot, you know, you have an increase in your chances of getting grants. So what I'm hoping is if we move forward with this lease program, not only will it offer more stability, but it also might open us up for additional funding to help offset it as well, and be a little more predictable in our costs.
Okay. So, hate to cut you short here, but we're okay.
Can I have one more question?
3 minutes. Real quick.
What's the percentage of, if you lease it, what responsibility is it to us, or is it on their shoulders if something happens to the gear?
The response, if something happens to the gear, they all come with warranties. Like the SCBA comes with an actual 15-year warranty, and the gear also comes with manufacturer wear warranties. Obviously, if somebody ruins a set of gear because, you know,
It can happen.
But if it's because of a defect in the material or the manufacturing or the way it is, then the company would own that for, I believe, on the tourniquet, I think it's a 5-year
okay,
warranty.
Thank you. I just want to make sure.
What's the cost of it, SCBA set, one SCBA?
You're looking at, I think it was in the area of $5,500. for that.
Okay, and gear?
The gear you're talking, I think it was 21-28 per set of turnout gear.
Okay, very good.
Thank you.
Thank you.
One quick question for Michelle. Well, you don't have to stay there. Start moving up. Michelle, on your line 117 here and 117 lines, are those where you're using the term reserve, are they reserve funds as described in the law as reserve funds?
The equipment expense reserve?
Well, you have an equipment expense reserve fund, okay?
Yes.
And then we have a fire truck capital improvement truck fund.
Yes.
Which of those, or are both reserve funds as we understand the term according to the law?
As they were voted on, the equipment reserve was the only one voted on as a reserve.
Okay, all right, thank you.
Okay.
All set.
Thank you.
Thank you, Chief.
Thank you.
Okay, we're about 6 minutes over, but rec department.
Department 113.
113. Morning.
Good morning. Lowry Robertson, for those of you who haven't met me. Operating on the assumption that you all have copies of this, yes?
They do.
Yes.
Okay. I just
give us a brief synopsis as to.
Synopsis, okay. Mostly this budget reflects maintaining programs that have been in place in the past. This is my first year with a rec, so I haven't tracked exactly everything that was actual expenses this year. There's a couple of new things that I'm hoping to do, and that would be I'm hoping to coordinate some kind of learn to ski program with King Pine up in Madison, New Hampshire. And the other things that are not new, the other change is that the Mouson Valley Little League is no longer extant. That was dissolved, and Acton kids are now going to Sanford Springvale, and Chapley kids are going to Shaker Pond, except for we are running T-ball in town. Other than that, the budget is just a continuation of previous programs.
Larry, did you want to speak on the stipend that you've included in there, that is new.
Might be a little oversight, huh? I put a stipend in this year for several reasons. The largest reason is because my understanding is that for several years, my predecessors were looking for people to step in and take their place, and no one had stepped forward, and then finally they decided that they were going to have to step down and move on to other things, regardless of whether or not someone took their place. So kind of at the 11th hour, I stepped in. I think that for the long-term good of the rec, that if there's a stipend for that position, then the chances of there being stability there is more likely. And that's basically the whole reasoning behind that. I tried to set the amount such that if you weren't volunteer-oriented, the stipend enough itself wouldn't be enough to induce you to do it. But if you were interested in contributing to your community, but you were kind of on the fence, then the stipend might help a person kind of move to the step of actually doing it.
This $2,000 would be given to one person?
To one person.
Mm-hmm. The other question I have, how many volunteers do you actually have at this point?
How many volunteers? There are three people on the committee.
I know it's tough.
As far as coaches are concerned, I've coached. Another member of the committee has coached. We have a few other coaches that have stepped forward for soccer and basketball. It's a member of the committee and his wife who are coaching T-ball. So, it's less than a dozen people probably who have been involved. That's been...
been tough.
Yes.
And who's going to decide about the stipend dispensing? To whom? Why?
Who's going to decide?
A little bit better.
I think it would be a recreation director of sorts rather than just the committee. You would have a director. Currently, Lowry is stepping up as the chair of the rec committee, and I would imagine that you know, the rec committee and the board would work together to.
So would I assume that because it would be starting this year, that it, in other words, to start a stipend for somebody should be effective at the next person, should it not, rather than a?
Or if it's approved in July, you could prorate it for the, you know, depending on.
Okay.
Or you could pay it per fiscal year.
It just, okay. When people ask for a salary increase, in this case, a salary period, it usually is applicable to the next person or the next election cycle or the next fiscal cycle or whatever. So that's my only question.
Next fiscal cycle it would be if it was approved.
Mm-hmm.
It would be the next fiscal cycle
right,
if it were approved,
right.
Yeah.
As things stand right now.
The person who's in it now is asking.
Right. But he could be in it next, you know.
Next?
Yes.
Yes. Next.
Yes.
Right.
Yes.
Yeah, it would not be immediately.
Okay.
Right. Yep. That's fine.
Okay, I guess I've been sort of out of the loop, but aware that there were problems with this program in town and that we had combined our activities with Shapley apparently for a while. what's your vision moving forward? Is there going to be an effort to move programs back into town so that they're available and run programs in town in addition to?
There's soccer now. You know, if you want an update on the status of the programs, soccer's been kind of small. The Pee Wee soccer has more people. So depending on the wave of participants that's moving through, we may be able to do more with that. We had this year for soccer, we had basically one team's worth of kids for the seniors and the juniors. We divided them up and they played each other. Next year we'd like to try and keep them as one team and play other towns and kind of increase the level of competition, and that may increase the interest.
That's all driven by numbers.
It's driven by numbers, yeah. You know, the reason that we are not the Mousam Valley Little League is no longer an entity is because we didn't have the numbers. Apparently the teams had to forfeit a number of games last year. So it made more sense to contribute those numbers to something that has more numbers to begin with and kind of strengthen that rather than trying to shuffle along and having to forfeit games and so on.
I just want to say, I think part of that, the numbers being low, is the lack of stability in getting the programs going at a decent time. And typically what happened is September's here at soccer season, who wants to run it? And nothing's been organized to get the teams going and play the other towns. To do it efficiently, you should be registering for soccer in May to get the teams organized and the games scheduled for the fall.
Yeah, this is the issue that I was going to. Is this lack of participation because we don't have the kids who are interested, or the organizational ability over your view is it's the overhead, the support?
Right.
I mean, it's a combination. In the past, I think there were a couple of years where we just didn't have enough kids, and instead of not offering teams for these kids to join, they combined with other towns just so these kids who did want to play at a. We're able to be involved in a sport. And I got to say about these, some of these directors in the past, the amount of time these people have put in, like Mark Canary and Ken Joy and Jana.
Jana Robichaud.
It's unbelievable. I mean, $2,000 is ridiculously low for what these folks do to keep these, with the scheduling and putting the teams together, organizing the coaches, and it's just, it's been great in Acton. Both of my kids went through the rec. For $2,000, it's the amount of work done is just, it's a deal. You know?
I agree with what you're saying, Jim, if it gets us to where we want to be. My concern is, though, do we lack kids who are eligible or willing to participate, or, and you're talking about, when we talk about hiring somebody, we're talking about somebody who can do the organizing and set these programs
right,
up right. And get them in place, and that's to the issue, really. If we don't have the kids, then...
But they're still organizing.
Kids, it's worth it.
They're still organizing.
Well, I agree.
Even if they have to combine with other towns, it's still, you know.
I agree. I just trying to get a sense for where this is going.
And that could only be one sport. There could be, yep. Within the same year, you could have enough kids that are, you know, playing basketball that aren't playing baseball or the other activities they offer, you know. So.
The other question I'd ask is, are we using the rec field now, or Are we conducting programs on the school grounds, and is there any effort to coordinate between the two?
We use the rec fields for soccer and t-ball.
Okay.
Yeah, so if it's an appropriate venue, then that's what we use.
Are there any programs conducted at the school?
Basketball is conducted at the school.
Right, yeah. Basketball has been, I know that.
Yeah.
Okay. So, and that's the only one?
Yes.
How do you get the coaches? You just reach out to parents? Is that still pretty much?
I reach out to parents, yeah. Been a few people who are highly motivated to coach.
Always, it's...
You know, and then there's a need to find some more of those people.
You guys did a fantastic job.
I think it has been a worthwhile program.
The other program you might want to look into, if we're looking at volunteers, is some of the high school kids, because they have to get 20 hours before they can even graduate.
We did.
Able to bring them in to make them help out, too.
Yeah, we did use high schoolers for refs for basketball, and that was really good. Some of them, we paid some of them, and some of them wanted community service hours.
Right.
And they did a great job.
Coach, it's
hard. It's not easy.
It's tough for a high school
kid.
We've done that. It's not easy.
Any other questions for him?
I just wanted to thank Larry for resuscitating this program.
And stepping up.
Yeah, I think it's really good, because it wouldn't be here if it wasn't for you stepping up and putting up, coming forward for it, so.
Thank you, sir.
All right.
Thank you. Yeah, we've got a couple of minutes. Let's just take a quick, we got about 4 minutes, so if anybody needs a break.
Department 104 is next. Sorry, 105. The beginning of 105.
Okay, we're back on here. Next we have the roads.
One.
And District 1. We can either do these separately or we can do them together, either way.
I think that'd be nice. Thank you.
We'll start with District 1. That's what we got down here on our list, so go right ahead.
All right. I just want to first start with, which budget are we discussing? The budget that I proposed or the budget that the selectman proposed?
You should discuss what your requests were.
Yep.
And they have a copy of it. They have both.
Well, Dave and I, we went through it quite well. We've changed up some equipment to be more adequate as far as the rates. We basically added 20% to each one of our major line items, plowing, sanding, which has always been low. If the town still wants to keep that low, we still have to plow the roads. As far as our paving and our highways and bridges money, we're just trying to get more done for the town. As far as our, there was, I don't know, it might have been mistaken, because online it looked like I was going for a special project, but it's not. That money's already in my budget for Sam Page that I'm going to redo. Sam Page, it's already in my budget for last year to do it for this spring. As far as our benefits and our requirements, we did some homework. The $16,000, Dave and I, we cannot get insurance unless we work 20 hours a week, which either one of us could drive around town 20 hours a week, do a little this, do a little that, and write it down and get benefits. But we choose not to. We do that, a lot of that stuff on our own, you know, taking phone calls, you know, just like we just been going through. How many phone calls did you take for road postings? You know, whether I'm on my own job site, this, my phone still rings, I got to answer this, I got to give Dave's number out. We don't charge for none of that stuff.
And a lot of times we'll send out other crew, because it's a lot more cost effective to send out a couple guys making, you know, $14, $15 an hour to do the same job that we're doing, but we still have to coordinate these guys to do these jobs.
And we're still trying to keep a crew at a low rate with not a lot of hours. It's hard to do when it's not really a full-time job in this town to have people on call, especially in the wintertime, in and this and that. So the $16,000 was for Dave and I for basically to provide for insurance. Whatever. The 45 was just, 4,500 is a requirement. It's just a, like a small pension that you would get down the road. Something. State retirement.
Mr. Chairman, can I interrupt for just a minute? I'm totally confused. And that's not an unusual state for me, but I'd like to be clear. Is this sheet the your request? Is that right? Because I've got a.
It looks like this.
District 1 and 2 combined.
Okay, this is the. It doesn't say request. I didn't know what this sheet
that's
was.
That's what they turned in. That's okay. Their request.
And then going to what has been offered to us, I think, from the treasurer.
Selectman.
This has, selectman, okay. This has nothing filled in for the request here, but you're showing an increase, and there doesn't seem to be.
Tom, what it is when we made our request to the selectman,
yep.
We made a request of 20% on our road surfacing, our highways, salt, sand, all that. The what you're looking at is a 10% that we didn't ask for. That was what the selectman asked for.
Okay, on their sheet, is that right?
Yeah.
Okay. Yes. So these numbers that are filled in on the right-hand column for fiscal year 2018, these numbers are the numbers proposed by the selectmen, is that correct? But not attributed to any particular line, is that?
No, well, no. The request
was not budget, it was not, it was just District 1 and 2, 91,836 is what they requested. Per each district, that was a 20% increase, and the board has tentatively thought to bring that down to a 10% increase. But there weren't specific line items broken out in the request, so we just left it blank.
Okay, I understand now. At least I know what I'm looking at. Thank you. Yeah. Go ahead.
I have some questions, if I might, please. First of all, on the summer maintenance and road resurfacing and reconstruction, where are the details about where the projects are, how big they are, and the estimated costs of each of the projects, other than the total sum that you're requesting? In other words, I worry about malfeasance in office for me and for my committee if we just approve a block grant for you to have a summer maintenance program and road surfacing and reconstruction without specifics. And I know your support and your existence is from the voters, because the Board of Selectmen really have no major administrative control.
Well,
but we do have control as far as the monies are concerned. And I can't see how we're going to be able to vote any money for road resurfacing and reconstruction unless you give us project by project what you plan on doing, how you picked that particular area, number two,
and
number three, about how much it's going to cost.
Well, I can answer that question. What we typically do, okay, of course, the money being spent is at the discretion of the road commissioners, okay? Mm-hmm. Now, what we do is every year, you know, we do our road sweeping, we do our general maintenance, spring cleanups, all that. We have an idea every year what that costs, okay? Now, we do it every year. We go around, we look at our projects. Now, I can name off six right now that I need to be done. But the problem is we've gotten so behind on our projects, okay, so what we've been doing is we take the money we have, we find a project like my project this year, okay, is the Hopper Road. One of many that I like to do, but that is gonna be my 2-year project. Now I've gone out and I've gotten prices for this project, sections at a time, and I'm up to about $400,000 worth of hot topping and this and that. So what, seeing I'm not getting that money, okay, so what I do is I'm taking, like what I've done this year is I've had a reserve from, I've got money left over this year for my paving. I have money left over that I purposely left there. Unfortunately, I'm doing something I don't normally do. I'm saving money so I can actually get a project done. And so, but with all these projects, I got one section of that road, 3,000 feet, that I got one price for $130,000 to do. I don't have that, okay? So what I'm doing is just building funds at this point, because this project is a $400,000 project overall. So our budgets change. We might have one year where I might only have to grade my roads twice a year, spring and fall. And we have some washouts, I gotta bring crew out. Everything's bound to change. I have a culvert on me, Hopper Road, that let go right in the middle of nowhere. We weren't planning on doing that section. Now I've gotta go in and do, there's always something there that you can't just go in and say, okay, we're gonna do this, we're gonna do this, we're gonna do this. There's always a thunder shower that comes through and washes something out, you know? So what we do is we look at what we have for projects lined up ahead. I got over $1 million worth of hot top I can put down tomorrow. And I asked for $18,000 more hot top this year, and I cut down $8,000. So I can give you all kinds of lists. I can write down exactly where, but it'll never be the same. It's gonna change. So what I do is I utilize what money I have, what project. And if I have extra money, that's why last year I said, I'm done with special projects. We need increases in this line item, so that when I can go from this project, I have money left over, I can go to the next one, at least start it. I use what I have, I utilize what money comes to me. And the town of Acton, they don't like it, they vote me out. And so far it's worked. But the problem is the funding part of it. We asked for a 20% increase. If you look back in 2015, when we had special projects, Scott and I both had special projects. I had roughly $60,000, ended up being $110,000 of special project money back in 2015. This year we were asking for roughly, and this is without, because when you look at the number of the $66,000 we're asking for above and beyond what last year's budget was, a lot of that's salt, sand, and plowing. I'm just talking $110,000 of road repair and surfacing, okay? So theoretically, what we were asking for is roughly $40,000 less than what we got 2 years ago. So, but the answer to your question is, we have a plan every year. We have a road, I've been working on Young's Ridge, trying to get whatever I can. I take the worst spots and I do them. Problem is, they're catching up with us. There's a lot of really bad spots, but there's not enough funding. And
in fairness to these guys, it goes back to what Tom was saying the other night. For them to try to explain that amount of detail in 20 minutes, basically what we're doing today.
I'm not asking them to explain it now.
No,
I'm asking them to give us a written project list. And whether or not you're able to get all the monies for it, fine. But if you do 3,000 feet of repavement on Hopper Road, then say we plan on doing this year based 3,000 feet at X number of dollars per 100 foot or whatever it is. So we have something. So we can then go back and say, okay, you asked for this last year. This is how much you did, and this is how much it cost us. To give you just a block grant can't be done anymore. It's as far as I'm concerned, it's illegal.
That's not what these guys, if I could finish what I was
saying. I'm sorry, go ahead.
If I could finish what I was saying. These guys here in the past have had, today we're talking about their numbers and their budget, but in order for these guys to give us detail like they've always done in the past, and I think it's what you referred to the other night, Tom, that there should be an additional meeting where these guys can come back and explain what their special projects are or where that money's going. I'm sure that all this information they can give us out in detail, and they're not just going to throw a lump sum of money out there and ask the people to. They've always come forward and, you know, proposed a plan or itemized the money or told us where they're going, you know. But to do it today with 20 minutes on the clock is...
The problem, I like the spring cleanup, okay? What I try to do is I take that $84,000, okay, and I break it up. Okay, whatever I have left, because we don't, you know, everything's an estimated number.
Mm-hmm, I understand that.
You know, my spring cleanup could take a week, it could take a month, okay? That number can change from 4,000 to 12,000 in a hurry, depending on the type of winter you have. So you're juggling numbers. There's a lot of juggling, okay? You know, I could sit here all day long and tell you what this cost, but it may not be same next week, okay? So,
I think you're missing what I'm asking. I'm not asking for it today.
You want an itemized of what we're doing.
What I'm asking for is give us some idea what you're going to do in the road surfacing and reconstruction.
Okay, I'll give you one right
if
now.
If you're unable to do
right,
it because
right now,
of cuts and
funds,
that's
fine.
Excuse
right
me,
now.
Dr. Williams, he's already told you what he's going to do.
I want it in writing, so I know how many running feet there are.
Put it in writing.
There might be something else come up.
That's
and
fine.
In writing.
Then you'll have some explanation for it.
If I put that I'm going to spend, because I already know right now, I've got almost $100,000 in surfacing saved up, and I've roughly got about $25,000 of prepare work to do on one section of about 3,000 feet, okay? But I can spend an extra 10 grand, 15 grand in a blink of an eye shimming the road, okay, with a hot top. So, but for me to put that number down, that's when you come back, because that's what you'll do, is to say and go, why are you $15,000 more on that project than you were before? That's what we're
then
afraid.
We'll have an explanation, and we'll know how much has been done. So we can look at DOT and say, you know, for 1 mile of pavement, it's $45,000.
I don't care what DOT does.
Okay. I do, though.
But I don't, because, see, I go to those seminars just like that one you went for 4 or 5 hours, okay? I go to those seminars. They don't do things like the towns do, okay? They have big
that.
Money, engineers, and all kinds of stuff.
And I understand the topography is different, but at least it gives me some idea within a range of perhaps what plus or minus 10 or 20,000.
Yeah.
All I'm saying is that if something comes up that's an emergency, of course, it's not going to be on the list of stuff that you gave us. But to give
so you want us right now special projects, what you want us to do.
I don't care how you do it. If you have a special project over 5 years, that's fine. Say this is stage one, and this is what we're going to do. This is stage two. This is what we're going to do. But to say we want $108,000 and we're going to fix some stuff, I don't know who asked you to fix it. I don't know.
Nobody has to ask us.
I don't know what your priorities are. Why did you pick Hopper Road, for example, versus some other road? Is this because of traffic density? Is this because of worsening of the surface over the last 12 months?
It's the road commission's determination, and when you're out plowing it and you're bottoming out with your
that's
plow,
that's fine. Then it's worsening
top,
surface. That's
you,
fine.
The
I understand.
Phone calls you get. So what I do is because that was a road that I'd like to have done a long time ago. But what I've done is I've done little small sections here, sections there, and now I've got to the point where I've neglected that road for, well, 8 years now. Now, that's my baby. That's one of my bucket list. That job to me is a priority, and the town of Acton voted me in to make that decision.
That's correct. That's correct. And that's what we're saying. If that is your choosing that road is because you found that that's deterioration and it's needed, for example, okay? If the road has 500 cars a day versus 100 cars a day, maybe that's one of your criteria.
Oh, definitely. You know, I right now, unfortunately, I have one road that's really terrible. I've got Lebanon Road.
Yes.
Okay. It's very bad. Okay.
And I've even had calls about Lebanon Road,
even
though it's a state aid road.
No, it's not.
But I was told it was.
Well, you should have called me.
Lebanon Road
is not a state aid road. It's my road.
That's the case, then the question would be, how come it's so smooth in Shapley, and the moment I get into Acton, it's all bad?
Did you drive into Lebanon and Sanford right behind it?
Because
this is my explanation to you.
Okay.
You were talking about road counters, this and that. Okay. Unfortunately, I hate doing this, but I almost have to do it because... Okay, you take the Hopper Road. There's a boatload of Acton Town residents that live on that road that use that every day.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? I got four houses that live on Lebanon Road that most of the people from Shapley and Sanford use as a cut across.
Correct.
Okay?
Correct.
I looked at the cost of fixing that road. Okay? I know what's underneath that road. Okay? And if you look at the Shapley Road where they went and did whatever, it's already falling apart.
Yes.
The road is a disaster. When I did this culverts in there, I was pulling stumps, everything else. So I'm looking at the cost of that section of road plus the amount of people that, unfortunately, there's only four residents living that. For me to go down and spend $500,000 to fix that road right, or do I go to Hopper Road where there's, you know, 60, 70 houses, which is a main artery in this town, that's how I make my decision.
If that's your criteria, that's fine. Just give us the criteria that you have.
And all you have to do is ask for it.
Okay. But you need to give us the projects that you want to do for the summer for repaving. And whether you are able to meet them or not, does it make any difference? We need to have some idea as to where the 108,000 is at least tentatively going to go.
Every year when we do a project, okay, and when we do our payrolls, it's all on what we do.
And all,
we
do, all the billing.
I think some of that responsibility falls on us as a committee, too, to offer you guys time to come in and explain this stuff. I'm sure you can put it in writing. Yeah. We have another meeting outside of today. Put it in writing. Sit down here with us like you've always done over the years and just explain it.
Well, it's just a, in the town book, every year we put down what we do.
Right. And then in the past, just like the school committee, we sat, we went line by line with them. If we don't have the information today, we can have another meeting and inform ourselves, and in fairness to you guys, be able to explain every one of these projects like you've done in the past.
Tom?
A number of years ago, back in the early 2000s, the Board of Selectmen, working with the road commissioners, the EMA director, put together a set of figures as a model for estimating the cost of rebuilding roads constructing drainage, et cetera, et cetera. In other words, every component we had, and my recollection is it was, I don't know, okay, but we based on some work we had done in that period of time, we had a cost per foot of rebuilding drainage, clearing brush, repaving, reconstruction of roads where it was needed, et cetera. I don't know if any of that information is available, but we were using it. We developed it specifically for cost estimating for FEMA, okay? So I'm suggesting that if there's any FEMA documentation around, some numbers may be available to go towards answering some of the questions that Dr. Williams is asking.
But these are the experts. I would take their numbers.
Wait a minute, Bill. The point is, it gives us an idea of what it costs to rebuild a road,
right,
what it costs to rebuild the edge of a road, et cetera. And from that, we can work with these guys and
but
say,
no
okay.
No one knows better than these two, and that's fine. That's fine. I would accept their figures for all those projects.
Lois, you were next.
I've never.
A quick question. Is it state? You get several state roads. How much of a percentage do they actually let you guys have to repair these roads?
None, just plowing.
Just plowing?
We can't repair them. I mean, I'll go out there and throw some sides, bump sides up, even though
blow away the wind.
Well, yeah. Well, we drive ours as fast as we can until it melts and they fall over. But, you know, I have calls all the time. You know, I've got sand in front of my house, Fox's Ridge, or one of this and that, da, 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 da. Bumps are bad. We get no money for maintenance at all. All my job is, because I don't think you ain't got any state roads. I've got the two state aid roads in town. And all I'm allowed to do is plow and sand them.
Yeah, because I know it's Fox's Ridge, Mills Road, and 109.
And 109, yeah.
Those are the three that I know of. I don't know if there's more beyond that.
There's no other state aid stuff.
I was just wondering if there's enough reports out on any of those three, is that when the state comes in and actually lends a hand or helps, or how's that actually?
Well, there's other things we could do. I've talked to the state about Milton Mills Road, okay? Over and over, every year I get the calls, and everybody thinks I take care of it because I plow it.
Yeah.
And it's terrible. But so what I do is I'll call them, complain, da, 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 da. But I've talked to the guys up the state when I go to these seminars and stuff, and I talk to them and say, what can we do? And the first thing they tell me is, well, if you've got some pavement in the last 10 years, yeah, you're probably not going to get anything. But I said, well, what can we do as a town? And they said, well, you can do this, you can do that. They'll do like a 50-50 where the town could come in and fix it, but that's a burden on the town of Acton.
Right.
So you take the Milton Mills Road, very, very costly to fix it, right.
And dynamited.
Yeah, but the problem you're having is where you're looking at, you know, our roads, and you're looking at the money that we have to invest to do, and then you put it on, you want to jump in on that bandwagon, we probably don't want them.
I was just curious because I know that, like I said, those three roads are primary roads that a lot of people use. Honestly, when our road looks like heck, and I live on Milton Mills Road, I take Hopper.
Yeah.
And pray that the end of Hopper is fine.
Well, next year when you take the Hopper, it'll be better.
It's just at the point of where we can only travel that road not even 100% of the time, probably 80% of the time.
Try plowing it.
Oh, I know. I watched you guys. I watched you guys. Matter of fact, one year, my husband actually helped when the plow was out because he couldn't get his chains on. So, I mean, we actually try to help out when we can. We've actually let them use our driveways if they have to use it to get off the road to do what they have to do. It's not a big issue. My problem is that we have three roads that are supposed to be maintained or helped maintained by the state. We need to get after the state to make sure they do these. I mean, these are major roads. They aren't just...
Cashin calls them once a day.
They aren't just, you know, little roads and all this.
Well, I guess the state is going to come in this year and do that section there from Carl Hurd's. Mark heard that whole section up through. They're supposed to be being done this year. They're supposed to actually rebuild it, but I'm not crossing my fingers.
I've lived on the road forever.
This is Milton Mills.
Milton Mills Road.
I think I've seen people fix it like five times. But no, I was just wondering if you did get any state aid other than what was relied on.
I don't believe we even get state aid for the plow, and I believe that's part of when we get our LRAP funds. I don't believe that we even get anything for that.
This is not, I'm not trying to touch a sore subject, but how do you guys actually pick your special projects? In other words, you just, like you said, you drive around and decide this, or do you actually have a lineup to how you pick it up?
I mean, we run our plow trucks, we get our phone calls, we see the roads that are deteriorating faster, and we, you know, like my projects, like I said, Sam Page, there's quite a few houses on it, from Nation Road to Goose Pond Road. But you go down that hill trying to plow it, and it's...
Plow tells you everything.
Yeah, oh yeah,
and
definitely.
So that's the spot I'm going to grind with this year's budget, and I'm going to base it in. And if I have enough money, I'd like to surface from there all the way there. So then now you can see that I've started at 109, I've gone to Nason, I've done Nason, then I've done Sam Page, I want to get that done. I've just resurfaced Goose Pond again. I just did 2.5 miles on the end of H Road, I mean Acton Ridge to the New Hampshire line. I've done from H Road all the way up. I mean, and if you can go back with numbers to my paving goes to paving.
Oh, I know, it doesn't get cheaper as the years go on either.
So I try to get as much done as I can. I'm sorry.
My last question, how many employees do you both have?
I've got I think it's seven. They're all part-time.
Part-time seasonal, both seasons?
I've got three guys that work year-round for the town. Four guys, I guess. I gotta count my dad, I guess. Four guys that year-round, and then I got three floaters that, you know, the retired guys that come in and drive truck for us, which is really great because, you know, when you're doing town work, does not work every day.
No.
There's not enough money in the budget to work them every day, so they come in when we need them.
And you, Scott?
I have four, five, depends on the winter time.
Are they part-time also?
Absolutely, and it's like it's hard to find, and I just want to say one other thing, that you just watched Shapley have their election on road commissioners, and there was two road commissioners up for election. There was one person that ran, one gentleman that's been there for, I don't know, 26, 27 years as a road commissioner. His son worked for him the whole time. Neither one of them wanted it.
Oh yeah.
This job is getting obsolete.
Thank you.
Tom, you next.
I'm just going to summarize this, hopefully, by saying this has been a very poor, very badly neglected part of the municipal budget for the past 10 years. Mm-hmm. And we are reaping the consequences of that. And the cost to repair and rebuild is 3 to 4 times what it is to do it right the first time. Mm-hmm. And we're going to pay that cost. And we're going to have to bite the bullet sooner or later. And the longer we let it go, the bigger the bullet's going to be.
The insurance that you guys have mentioned in your budget, it was 16,000, is that?
That's roughly what some of the towns people get.
Per road commissioner?
Yes.
Per road commissioner. And what is that, Ed or Michelle, is it 20 hours a week you have to have?
21 all year round.
And where is that guideline? Is that a town policy?
That's a town policy. Yep.
I think also that's part of the what the insurance company is looking for.
The insurance company requires for anybody to have the insurance, they have to have it documented 10 hours a week. Town policy calls for 21 hours a week. And with that 10 hours a week for that the insurance company requires, at least one person must be working 40 hours a week.
That's decreased then, because when I set that program up initially back, the minimum was 20 hours. They had to be working 20 hours.
When you say one person 40 hours a week, is that their total budget for a week showing that they've asked for 40 hours worth of pay, or is that one individual?
One individual working for the town has to work 40 hours a week.
In order to qualify
for the benefits.
Well, let's make clear what we're talking about here. We're talking about being a member of the group. There are a number of different ways you can acquire insurance. As an individual, that would be done outside of the group if the regulations prohibited.
Right, so Jim, she's not saying that one person in the roads has to work 40 hours. For the town's policy and to qualify, one person in the town has to work 40 hours, and then the 10 and slash 21 picks up.
Okay. So if this was voted through for these guys here, essentially the only thing that would have to be changed is the policy? Vote of the selectmen?
I think what they're asking for is not to be added onto the insurance, but to be given a stipend.
Yeah, they don't want they're not asking for the insurance,
and
are you?
So
well, we've had the insurance before. Then it got down to, we only averaged 12 or 13 hours a week, and it was taken away.
Yeah, so it was actually then I've asked and asked. Town meeting floor many years back that the road commissioners would not be eligible for insurance.
Right. After they were.
Right, they were, and that was a split between the two road commissioners at the time. One supported it, one did not. We had we had quite a battle on town meeting.
But I mean, this is a new year and a new request.
Yeah, well, but are you guys looking for health insurance?
I mean, this $16,000, it's in case we don't have insurance.
So are you, I guess
it's all it's like our aggravation of all the phone calls. All the
so you're looking for the stipend, not to be added to the insurance.
Stipend than it is insurance, and it could be.
Which one do you want?
I
think to get by some of the stuff that you're talking about, it would probably be better off as a stipend at that point.
That's what I thought. They don't want the insurance.
That makes more sense.
Okay.
And you can spend it on however you want to spend
insurance.
It.
Insurance.
Yeah, you can use the money for whatever you want to use the money for. So
now we were talking about, you know, the budgets and all this, and, you know, what time we put into the job and how much time we spend on the phone with people. I got real estate agents that call me all the time. Do you take care of this road? I got on the phone with this morning. You know, is this a town road? Do you do this? Do you do that? We spend a lot of time when we're even not on the job. We spend a lot of time. Payrolls, you know, sure. Talking Dayton sand and gravel and salt companies and this and that. And, and also, you know, when you look around, you see, you know, we put, I believe we put more time in our department than probably a lot of people don't see, but we, as much as some of the other departments in this town, and we said, you know what, it might be fair.
Just like everybody that works for themselves works twice as hard as those who work.
Exactly. And
Jim, I have another question about, and help clarify this for me, about the three bridges that cross into New Hampshire.
Yep.
The Hopper Bridge, I'm told, is all Acton, Maine responsibility, both sides.
No.
It's not correct.
No, it's Acton has no responsibility to that bridge.
The state of Maine?
State of Maine.
But both sides?
State of Maine.
Okay. And the canal is all in, the canal bridge is all in New Hampshire? Except
state
for the
Maine.
Approach, obviously, on the Maine side.
From what the guy from the state of Maine told me, enlightened me, that these bridges were the state of Maine's issue. Anything over 20 feet is the state of Maine. I don't know. You're looking.
It's just different from what I was told by other people, but that's.
Well, I mean, I'm just talking to people that know what they're talking about.
Okay.
But the. and I've been doing this since, you know.
That's fine. That's why I'm asking you for information.
Okay,
so none of these two bridges have anything to
do. The Milton Mills Hopper Road Bridge, the guy from the state, same guy that was working on the Milton Mills Road, putting the barricades up, says that we do not have any responsibility over that bridge. Now, on the other hand, like Scott just got one given to him, the one up on Bulch Lake. It was over a 20-foot span. Now it's not. Now it's Scott's and Newfield's problem. But as this time, as it sits right now, we have no There's nothing to do with us.
David, can I ask, do you...
It was a happy day when I was told that.
Yeah, well, yeah, but I just wonder if you have that on paper someplace, because there's been years of discussion back and forth across the border, and there are a lot of different answers to the question.
Well, that's the reason why, like...
I'm hopeful that you have that on paper from
the state. You know, I asked the guy twice, because, you know, when he come in, he said, you know, he was doing, you know, when they do the inspections, the state does the inspections.
Yeah,
okay?
Right.
They're responsible. They're the ones who shut the bridge down. We can't do that.
Right.
Okay? When I asked the fella, I can't remember his name off the top of my head, but he explained to me that the state of Maine, that's their obligation. Okay? And I said, well, what about the state of New Hampshire? And he said, well, that's another story.
The issue here is what we mean by the obligation, okay? They may be obliged to regulate it, they may be obliged to rebuild it, they may be, who knows, okay? But we need to get that clarified. There are a number of stories.
We need to get those clarified, because we just got a certificate from the state of New Hampshire.
Yeah, they send us a bridge report every couple of years or whatever.
Do we get one from Maine also for that bridge?
Yeah.
Okay.
A matter of fact, I met with the bridge engineer last year, I think it was last year, went over it, because there was certain individuals in town that become bridge experts because they went to a DOT class and said that the bridge was unpassable. So I actually brought the bridge engineer down and said there was nothing wrong with it. So, I mean, just to ease me and the town of Acton, I wanted to make sure before I got into we're going to be spending $500,000 for a bridge.
Correct.
So, we've got those bridge reports, and, like I said, there's a bunch of them. I think there's only like 10 inspectors in the state of Maine, and I forget how many bridges there, but there's a lot of them. So, you know, it's every couple of years that they do it, you know. But I actually had the bridge inspector up on the canal bridge, you know, and... that right there, that's a whole other story, you know.
Yeah, on the canal bridge, there was some aspect of it being a historic, historic interest or to be protected.
State of New Hampshire, I think
it's
they
been
were
declared.
Trying to get that through the historical.
Yes, it's the state
it's been
of
declared.
And I believe they did, didn't they?
They did, I think.
And the problem was I wasn't advocating for that. I wasn't. Problem is, if you make it an historical thing, I can't
You're
touch
limited
it.
Limited as to
can't
what
do nothing
you can do
to
with
it,
it
because now it's federal.
Yeah.
So, but at the same time, if they make it an historical thing, the feds are going to fix it.
Well, I know that this has been going on for almost 20 years, trying to do something about that bridge, and the state of New Hampshire was willing to fix it, but that's about 7 years out from now.
Well, that was 7 years from the time the declaration.
That was probably before the Milton Bridge let go, and that one's still out.
Yes.
And, priority list.
It was my understanding during those discussions, and I was EMA director at the time, that the problems arose on that bridge. The state of New Hampshire and both Maine and the state of New Hampshire did some kind of quick review on ownership and responsibility for reconstruction, and it was decided that the responsibility was split between the two, and New Hampshire prioritized it to be 7 years out from the time of the declaration. The state of Maine did not. We dropped all discussion of it because we were waiting for the state of New Hampshire to be ready to begin to deal with their half before we did, and that's where that stopped. And I don't know if anything further has happened.
Well, the state of New Hampshire, one side says it's an historical.
Yep.
State of Maine does not recognize it.
Well, that's what we had on conservation, is that it was a 50-50 split, but they didn't want us to do anything to it because it was historical and there was still an argument.
Right. Well, the argument was just postponed because there was no chance of doing anything until that 7-year scheduling date had expired, and I imagine we're close to that now.
I also imagine
that New Hampshire's probably bumped their time frame back some too.
I just have a question about the budget.
Okay. Yeah.
Hmm.
On your dozers D3, D4, $24,000 at road commissioner's discretion. What does that mean?
Well, it depends how new they are. How efficient they are. Do they have a six-way blade? Are they a high track? Are they a wide track? It's, there's so many different types of equipment out there. You can't just put one number on it, and it's more or less, it's, it would be
a specialty.
It'd be a piece of equipment that we would rent or hire another contractor, and we can't say, we're going to give you $57 an hour for your machine when that person's getting $120 an hour all day long.
The problem you have is...
It's something that we have out there.
You know, the problem you have is some of these machines, you take a 1984 D3, you know, it's a 9-ton machine, and now the new D3s are 12, you know, full enclosed cab, you know, $150,000 piece of equipment. So, you know, depending on who you hire, it was almost impossible for us to come up with a number, because we don't want to come up with a high number for a later model machine to come in and do something, and then have, you know, a 1984 D3 come in and get the same thing. It was hard to make that number right. With a loader, you can do that. You know, a three-yard bucket's a three-yard bucket, you know. But, so that's why we put on there for the discretion of the road commissioners, and obviously it would be something that we'd price out and come to the select and say, this, we got three prices for this, whatever, you know. But it was almost impossible. And the state rates that they had back in the day, they were so out of touch that you couldn't hire anybody. Nobody was going to run for those rates. Yeah, it just didn't work.
Jennifer, you had something?
Yeah, just real quick, in closing, I just want to go back to the stipend thing for a minute and make sure that I'm understanding. So when the board goes back and reconsiders putting stuff back in, when they first had the conversation, we thought it was insurance. So that was taken out for that purpose. So now that it's a stipend, I just want the board and the Warren and Finance to kind of hear my thoughts on it briefly. So if we took that 16.5 and we divided it by 52 weeks, they'd get a little over $300 a week for a stipend. I can tell you from my position that I call these two guys sometimes 2, 3, 4, 5 times a day because of the calls coming into my office, whether, you know, for road related or trees. I mean, they communicate with me 24/7, you know, whether it's weekends, weeknights. This will help me as well, because when it comes down to drug testing, if they're getting a stipend, they're going to be on the clock for that, you know, for a period. So it's helpful too, because you can't, because, you know, you never know when they're on duty unless it's in the middle of a snowstorm. So it, you know, it's difficult to call them and address all the concerns in the town every day, whether it be a posted road or whether, you know, someone needs to travel over a posted road, by calling them and not knowing if, you know, if they should be available, if they're actually working. So, I mean, from my point and from what I see, and I certainly don't get involved in a lot of this stuff, that those stipends for those positions, I mean, they're working more times than not for the town. It benefits the town, because now I know you have to take my call and help me get through the situation.
we take that off the table.
Yeah. So just remember, boys, now you're going to get a stipend.
Yeah. Gentlemen, I just...
It's true, though.
You and X, actually.
Yeah, I just want to thank these guys after another brutal winter, you know, for the job you did taking care of our roads. And always know when you drive into Acton, and I'm not just saying that, everyone that I know feels the same way, that our roads are as good or better than anybody's, and it's a good feeling laying in bed at 2 o'clock in the morning and hearing the plow trucks go by and knowing that I can stay there and know that I'm getting out, fall asleep warm in bed and know I'm getting out in the morning knowing you guys are out doing your job. So
sorry about the mailbox.
Yeah,
thank you.
Gentlemen,
I don't know, I saw it down and you got four different trucks go by there. I can't blame, I know I didn't do it, but I can blame it on my father.
One of the heavy storms.
Gentlemen,
my dog goes ballistic.
I am in total agreement that you all are deserving of a stipend, okay? All I'm asking is, don't make us give you a permission for a block grant. List, you, I don't care what you call them, my bucket list, my wish list for this coming year, for this coming summer, the projects that you want to do. If you aren't able to do them because they've taken money away or some other event has occurred that you have to divert your attention to something else, that's fine. That's explainable. But we cannot just give monies away with a verbal idea that we know that you're going to do a great job.
And they know that. They heard that from the board. We were going to meet with them. They were going to work on a list, and we'll all get together, and before the next meeting, we'll put
that.
Something together.
You guys would be willing to come back and explain that information?
Sure.
Yeah, to best of our ability. I mean,
please.
Like you said, it's a wish list that might not even
fruit right. come to fruition. Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
No,
it's more of a, I mean, that's what I'm saying. I've been here so long. I've listened to so many Wharton Finance. I've listened to so many selectmen. It's so hard to explain that our job is consistently changing every day.
Every day.
Every day.
That's fine.
Be able to come back and explain.
It's like trying to explain how much times I'm going to go out plowing this year, this winter.
Yeah, right.
It's Mother Nature.
Yeah.
You know, how can I?
And there's going to be additional questions for every department, and if we ask them to come back, you'll be able to explain.
Yes, I'll try to explain the best I can, but I'm not going to go and spend 50 hours or 20 hours trying to line down everything, and then do I follow that, or do I go out and use my heart and go out and do my job?
Just the best you can.
Okay, no one is asking you to do the
over here on this, so.
Well, I feel, Dr. Williams, you're asking me to write down a list that I don't have to follow. So what is the good?
If you don't follow it, then they tell us why we're unable to.
You know, that's what, I just don't understand. I just don't understand.
We can't go any further on that conversation. That'll be something. So when you get together with the group again.
And I'm sorry. I'm going through some problems.
It's okay, Scott. Don't worry.
You know, okay. And I'm a little emotional.
Tom, quick.
Traditionally, the special projects in this description that you're looking for has been worked out between the Finance Committee, the Road Commissioners, and the Selectmen in a common group, and we put that together and made that proposal.
So they have an opportunity.
So we're all in agreement, but we need to do that, obviously, in more than 15 minutes.
In a more formal way.
And we can do it as well.
And a lot of the times, we really got to have an idea of what we're going to be able to spend before we can make those projects up. I mean, I can come up with a wish list all day long, but if we're only going to continue on with $90,000 or $99,000 a year in Hot Top, well, then, you know, the projects stay the same.
Okay. We got to knock it off now because we're 5 minutes over. So
good.
I do like the idea of the stipend. That's just me in closing. You guys don't get a dime, really, unless your trucks are on the road.
But they would get that pay on top of their stipend.
The only way you guys make any money is for your truck to be on the road. When you take a phone call, when you prepare your budgets, everything else you do,
when we're sitting in October and we're working on our trucks in our shop for a month to be ready for November, and I'm spending up to 20 grand, up to 20 grand easily to be ready.
Yep.
I think the biggest thing that really is tough for me is in the middle of wintertime when you're up hours and hours waiting for that snowflake to fly because the news, the Weather Channel said it was supposed to start at 2 a.m. in the morning. It doesn't start until 8 a.m. Yeah. You know, it's a lot of time.
But this stipend is just for the two elected positions, right?
Right.
Not the. Okay.
Right.
Nobody else.
Good stuff.
Okay. Thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you.
Welcome to New England.
Yeah.
Okay. Next up is APAT. That is which section?
111.
111. Mike?
Hey, everybody.
How are you?
Good.
Good.
How are you, Michael?
All right.
He's wearing shorts. He's an optimist.
It's short season.
Or something?
Of course it is. I have in front of me not my proposal, but what I discussed with the selectmen
111
at our last meeting. Similar to the road commission, I was here during that discussion. I too track my hours. When I originally came on here nearly 12 years ago, we were using old-fashioned techniques, and I was averaging roughly 15 to 20 hours a week to produce video. Last week, I believe it was, we covered nearly 9 hours of event meetings. That's all I really need to get that job done nowadays in production is 9 hours versus 20. So based on the work that I've done to make this production process more efficient, I've kind of started
working yourself out of a job.
Exactly. So the board and I agreed on a salary reduction based on the 5 to 10 hours I average weekly. We're maintaining it as a salary, not hourly, correct?
Yes.
All right, and that's what we're in agreement with. Again, this budget doesn't come out of the town as a tax. In fact, it will go back to the town to offset, which will be an added benefit for the town. So the reductions you'll see is in relationship to my salary being decreased.
Go ahead. The fees that we do for the cable as well, I mean, for people that pay, that mm-hmm. have MetroCast.
Yep.
What happens to the fees that you guys accumulate?
We get a check.
Okay.
And that's where this is.
That's why I was wondering.
Right. We usually average a $40,000 annually, and the town receives a check, and that's where my budget is paid for. So if you look at the bottom line number, you know, technically there'll be about $6,000 if I don't spend any on equipment. Could potentially be $8,000 if I don't spend any on equipment going back into the town's revenue offset.
Now I'll go back to Jen. Will that also change on the phones?
I'm sorry?
The phone system that
he
has here, that wasn't changed.
Yeah, well, very little. I mean, his phone bills have to be minimal.
Yeah, or, and then his
they're not?
Telephone cable bill is...
Oh, that's the internet.
It's one, his phone, mm-hmm. and the other is the... Explain it.
High-speed internet yeah. connection that we use okay. to push the huge files up to the internet.
Right, MetroCast gives the town free right. basic, but he needed to upgrade, so that's where that money comes from.
Now, so what we get back from them actually subsidizes you, so basically it's a kind of like a wash.
Yeah.
We're not really giving you extra money at this point, or are we?
Oh yeah, yeah, definitely will be received. The town will be receiving
right.
money. Yes.
Well, what I'm saying is that we're not beyond the 40. We're not giving more. In other words, we're not taking more than what they're giving.
No.
Less.
He's the one. I think probably the one of the only entities in town that actually.
Yeah.
is it none of it comes out of the tax dollars.
Exactly, and that's what I was trying to get to, because I saw when I was reading through, and I knew that we all get charged a fee because we're part of that program.
Yep.
Plus it says on my little old bill.
Those that are on MetroCast, correct, yes.
That, and I wanted to make sure that everybody understood that this is one of the entities that we're not, you know, it really is as a wash. They take care of themselves.
And it's a good time to mention that Michael has been working hard with MetroCast as far as our contract. It's coming up this year, so we're just starting to get in touch with the right people. And when they signed the first contract, the board at that time went with the highest percentage, which was 5%. Mm-hmm. And we're certainly looking to bring that down to hopefully, you know, at least 3.5 or 4. And that's the percentage that you pay on your bill. So if we can bring that down some based on what he turns back into the undesignated fund, it'll help the townspeople.
Which also means that
less revenue coming in,
right? Which means there might be less money going towards town
right.
to offset taxes.
But they're paying it twice though, because you're paying it
right.
on the bill.
Yeah, exactly.
Right.
But would that be a wise idea? Can he work within that if he does do that?
That would be yes. something he'd have to look at.
I've crunched numbers.
Actually, Tom's next.
Oh, go ahead.
Question with respect to the MetroCast contract, when is that due, and are you talking with anybody else? Because I don't, I'm skeptical that they're keeping up to where they should be.
The problem with,
go ahead.
It's a monopoly.
Yep. Well, I understand
the problem
that.
With
that
cable money. Services is it's yeah. a monopoly.
Right.
They own the cables on the telephone poles. Having another company come in here to run their own cables, the other company would have to see profit involved in doing so.
I understand that, but there are scenarios where the transfer actually takes place, where a replacement company actually purchases from the owner, and
that would be up to MetroCast to sell.
Well, that's true, but if MetroCast isn't making any money.
Yeah, they don't have a contract. So, they don't want the
right.
cable.
I'm just suggesting that maybe we need to look into that because. Well,
I guess I'm understanding who are we going to look into it with?
Time Warner, maybe right across the border in New Hampshire. They are.
Right, but MetroCast owns these lines, so we want to get quotes to see if Time Warner will come provide cable. Or you're saying just for the Channel 26?
No, I'm talking about whether they provide cable. There is the interconnection. These changes do take place. It is possible.
No,
to
I. Okay.
The only reason, only way they come in is if they did take over those cables, and that would be.
Almost impossible. Yeah,
yeah,
I agree.
It's difficult. I know.
You'd have to sit at the table with MetroCast, Time Warner, and the town folk to come with an agreement. And there has to be some profit involved for the corporations to agree upon that.
You said Time Warner would have to want to sell. I mean, MetroCast would have to want to sell.
Well,
they don't.
Chances are.
Well, But it's been done, and it can be looked into, and and I only mentioned Time Warner because their cable butts are something, you know.
They do. They cover maybe like a fraction of a percentage of Acton residents. And the remainders are in Metrocast.
So just a question.
Yeah, my question was in the same vein, wondering about that contract. The, who provides cable in Sanford, do you know?
Metrocast.
Metrocast. Okay, so they're all in the area. All right.
Yep. I believe it's on the New Hampshire border, like Time Warner.
I know.
Unless you go with Dish, and that's not going to help.
Unless you go with Dish or satellite or some other place.
It's not kind of free market at all.
Weather dependent.
The dial-up.
Dish is always an option. So.
We'll check, though. I'll check with Michael and I.
Anybody else have any questions for Mike?
Shake the tree and let them know we're around, that it is possible to do.
What's that?
Any other questions for Mike?
Time Warner may be very
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Mike. Okay. General government, code enforcement and planning.
Department 102, second page.
And his wasn't cut at all by the selectman, right? Was there any changes? No.
No.
So the budget here is what this, it's the same, proposed and being moved forward.
For all the line items?
We're looking at just the land use.
Yeah.
Yeah, all the way down.
Okay.
No vote this year, Kenny?
Already got it. It's paid for itself already.
In terms of fines or something, well, that's right.
Basically, yeah.
Where are we?
Yeah, that's a good one.
I don't imagine.
I'm sorry?
You said 102, right?
Yep, second
yep.
page.
Second page.
It starts with the town administrator, goes down to land use. You're looking at land use. Find it?
Yep.
Thank you.
102.
Mm-hmm. Fine, thank you. Okay. Morning, Kevin.
Morning. Any questions, or you want me to go down through it, or?
Just kind of explain where you are and what.
The only spike we're seeing is in the secretarial duties, and my secretary is starting to pick up some additional duties that the town administrator was doing, and she'll be starting to work on that.
Anyone have any questions for Ken?
Actually, I want to thank you for your department at this point, because I really appreciate it. She's done really phenomenal for helping me to get what I have to do. And,
yeah. You're welcome.
I appreciate it.
And you'll see, I'm sorry, when we start talking about the other secretarial lines and how many actual bodies we have running the everything from the town hall, we increased Brenda's hours. We budgeted, I think, for up to 40. She may not need that many every week, but if we can start tying some of our assessing into some of the maps online into what she's doing when she's issuing building permits, and we're just finding a more efficient way to things for things to go, and she's offered to pick up a few extra hours. So.
I was here on Friday and I watched her work, and it was amazing just to see what she does.
Very good worker.
Mr. Paul, just one question. Just one question. It's unusual to see a bump and then going back down on legal fees. Is there a reason why we were higher last year?
I'll address that.
Okay.
Legal fees were previously in the planning board line. Ken, his title with the town has changed to land use director. So we've taken the planning board, the previous planning board budget, and the code enforcement officer and meshed them together. So they're all here now.
Oh, okay. That's
so right. The legal was never in code enforcement before, and now it is.
Thank you.
Most of the legal fees, we try to, if we have to go that route, we try to get those paid back as well, too, by the other party, which is, I think, mostly successful last year.
Yes, yes.
I thought that line was to cover Tom Cashin on the planning board.
Conservation, better yet.
No, but we have a new policy, so we have to go through three or four people before we expend that legal line now. Tom's got to get through those hurdles before we'll...
I'm under that. Kenny Paul has been a wonderful guy to work with since his hiring, and it's only gotten better in terms of the smooth operation of the planning board, from my chair.
Yeah, Tom?
And as I'm looking at this right now, I see year-to-date receipts in this department, and I'm going to have to come back to you in a minute. I'm back on revenue summary. We're about $70,000 in income realized through the work that's done here, but I see an uncollected balance. I see uncollected balances listed there also. Explanation for what those numbers are?
No, there's no, he's collected above and beyond what we budgeted.
That's why.
Well, I see that, no question. But my next line on my revenue summary report is uncollected balance.
So he has collected $25,000 more.
Oh, I see.
Than the $47,200 that was budgeted.
All right, now I understand.
Yeah.
I thought that was unrealized income. Okay.
No.
Thank you, Michelle, for clarifying that.
Any other question? Yep.
Ken has been draining swamps. That's where that comes from.
Muckworks, huh?
Well-oiled machine down there, Kenny.
Thank you, sir.
Guys, you do very, very well. I really appreciate it.
A lot of people think Acton is an extremely rural town, but we're almost 50 square miles with 125 miles of shoreline zoning, and it's almost 75% of our tax revenues coming from the shoreline zone. So it's a lot of work just in that one area.
Never easy. It never always continues. And I thank you for your time and Brenda's. Just really well.
Right.
Any other questions for Ken?
No.
Anything else you want to add, Ken?
Oh, I could sit here and gab, but okay. You guys are going to love it.
Thank you very much. Good job.
Enjoy your day.
Appreciate it.
You're kidding.
You're next.
Oh. Where are we at?
Okay.
Where's the voter registration?
Does anybody need a break, or are we?
No, let's go.
I like that. No, let's go. What are you going to do?
That's okay.
We're ahead of schedule by about 20 minutes.
We went from one extreme to the next.
Yeah, yep. The schedule's right there.
Yep.
I'll get caught back. I'll slow back down.
Pocket there.
So we're still on Department 102. We'll be on the first page.
Second
here.
Page.
Okay.
Should we, so where the next ones are all general government, should we just go down from the top?
I think that's probably easier.
So if we're on the first page of 102 between Michelle and I and Ed, we can just whip right down through?
Sure.
All right, start us off, Michelle.
The first governing body, that of course is the Selectman's Office. There are no proposed increases there this year.
Next is the gym. We are leaving everything. Well, we went down a little bit on the heat, just hoping we could save a little with the electricity we had to go up on. So, minor, washes itself out.
Sorry. I have one question on the gym. Do your members offset some of the cost in
yes.
that, or is there not, or are we still over, or got too much overhead on that? You know what I'm saying? Does one wash out the other?
No. Each year is different, but let's look at last year's.
Currently, this year we have brought in over 5,300, so it's more than paid for itself this year.
Wow. Last year, though, we were 3,000 negative, I think, in the heat. So
yeah, so
I know it's hard, but I just want to make sure that it's something that we're not over, you know. We're not.
No, we've tried to collect the fees just to maintain
what's
going on.
Tom?
A couple of years ago and last year also, I think I made the suggestion that some consideration be given to turning over the management of that operation to the Recreation Department. If we're going to have a paid manager for that department, it seems like a good place to integrate some management. So just a thought moving forward. When you have a chance, you might talk with our rec director and see if he has any interest.
Yeah, I think the only difficulty with that would be is obviously the town's still liable. We have release forms that they have to sign, having to get the money, you know, being able to come into regular business hours, sign the release, pay the money, get the receipt, get the key, you know, the stipend, unless they're going to have regular hours to meet with people, you know, it may be something hard for them to do, especially where the town's insurance covers them as well. We've been doing spot checks to make sure that people over there have the releases and they're not sharing keys and so forth. So
it's worth exploring. It gives them another avenue to involve people.
Yeah.
And I don't have all the answers to the problems, mm-hmm. but I'm sure they exist somewhere. So just a thought moving forward.
The next line is office assistant line. This is more than one assistant. This is one full-time assistant.
A couple of half-times?
A couple of half-time assistants, our general assistance administrator, and coverage for the town clerk, town administrator when she is away.
Say that one more time. One full-time, two half-time, and...
General assistants.
Mm-hmm.
And then coverage for...
Vacation.
Vacation.
So the increase there primarily went from increasing the hours of the current full-time assistant. You know, just like every other department, you may see the town hall is open 21 to 25 hours a week, but, you know, it's really taking, 40, 50 hours a week to run it, so...
She's working behind closed doors. She's just not admitting.
Yes. So we're going to start parking out back because people like to knock on the door when they see cars. We have plenty to do, I assure you. That's a small increase. Next one, warrant and finance clerical. We were actually just talking about this on Thursday. They have not expended it, and I put out the offer to the warrant and finance chair that in the past, we've always had this line so that if we needed to send an hourly employee to take an official vote, we'd have a little bit of money to cover this. So it's certainly something that we can start utilizing more in the future if the committee so chooses.
Municipal management.
This is me. This is, yeah, I know.
The office manager salary we've taken out of there. The position of the office manager has changed. The board created a town administrator who has multiple duties. So that...
The money is being taken out of there.
Yeah, it's taken out of there and added in somewhere else.
Which on the next page.
On the next page.
On the next page, and we'll get there.
We'll...
Okay. Unemployment is staying the same. Health insurance, it's a guessing game what health insurance is going to do. We have the new presidency, and our policy doesn't renew until September, and we can't get estimated rates in April.
Right.
Are they all family plans or single plans or a combination?
There are a combination. There's two family plan, three family plans. Two employee with spouses and a couple of singles.
But it's group insurance?
Yes.
Okay. With which company?
Aetna.
With Aetna. Okay.
Now, do you guys shop around for insurance at any point in time, or is that
every year?
Every year.
Every year? Okay, thank you.
Is there much difference between them? For example, the school board has already gotten theirs, and they have Anthem.
Anthem, with our small of a group, their rates were quite a bit higher, and we are on, our plan is a high deductible plan. It's $5,200 deductible, so everything that we hit first hits the deductible before the insurance kicks in.
I got you.
And that's what we chose to keep the cost down. And with the contributions through the personnel policy that the town makes to the health savings accounts to the employees, it's been helping. I can't say that, you know, it's the greatest.
But you do have an HSA.
Yes.
Yes.
Now we do. Yes. Yes.
But certainly, you know, it's getting us through.
Good.
Decreases in Social Security and Medicare are due to the movement of that office manager's salary. Longevity benefits package. So this includes vacation buyouts, as discussed in our personnel policy. There's a longevity bonus, per se, for employees who work 10 years or more. This is what the board came up with a couple years ago, I think,
we were
as
going
incentive
to stay with the town.
To keep our employees here. We have had very high turnover. And so this year, that's going up, one, because proposed salary is going up a little bit. And we have more people that are eligible this year, that have met the 10-year mark or the 5-year mark for vacation buyout.
I like the purpose of this, but I am, or if I understand the purpose, it's to preserve continuity in employment, and that's good. So are you still in the business of training future town clerks for other municipalities at this point in time, or has have you lost that job?
So far I've had Sarah for a year, but that's
almost two years.
It's been that long.
So who is seeing these longevity benefits, and what has the benefit been?
Well, I mean, and when we lost the last clerk to Lebanon, that was 2 years ago. That's when we really started saying, you know what, we got to do something. So she's just starting. If she's close to hitting 2 years, she's working up towards that longevity.
Yeah, the first benefit is seen at 5 years,
right.
For vacation buyout for anything that you don't use.
But the main PERS, we've increased the hourly rate in those positions.
So is that the full benefit, the buyout of vacation time you don't use, or is there an additional?
No, there's specifics to it.
Okay. I mean, why are we probably not creating some sort of step function in here for people who stay longer? That's kind of what this is, isn't it?
No, there are steps.
Yeah.
It's not everybody doesn't get the same thing at once. Let me pull up.
No, I understand that. I'm just trying to understand this more because there has been some talk about it. And
so
I don't know the answer to questions.
Yeah, we have steps at 5, 8, and 10 years for vacation buyouts. What the town would buy out if you had leftover vacation. And then the bonus is capped at 10 years before we give a bonus at the end of the year.
Okay, can I just back up a minute? Now, what happens if you have this buyout, say, at the five-year time? Is that sum now added to your salary, or is that just a one-time buyout option?
Well, the vacation is budgeted in. So if we have a five-year employee that's eligible for, you know, 3 weeks of vacation,
right,
if they don't take it and we buy one out, it's still in the budget because we've budgeted for what each staff member is eligible for.
I agree. I understand and I agree.
So yeah, I'm just wondering. It gets paid as a wage. So there, it's taxed as a wage. It's not included in their salary because they might not use it. I mean,
they may use it as sick time.
Right.
Yes.
Right,
for that particular case. So that's a one-time cash transaction then.
One time a year.
One time a year, the buyout.
That's your anniversary.
Or is that sum then added to added every year, included every year?
Yes.
In other words, if you have a buyout, okay, at 5 years, okay?
Yeah.
Now let's presume that that's worth $3,000 to somebody, just to
wow,
take an arbitrary figure. Does that automatically add? I know, that's okay. That's why I qualified it. Is that then subsequently added to that person's basic remuneration, if you will?
Well, no, I mean, it's recalculated each year on their hourly rate and their term.
Budgeted.
Right. Mm. So, I mean, so every year when you're putting the budget together for your hourly employee, you know, like let's say at 4 years they get 2 weeks vacation and they can't buy anything out. So we have staff coverage for 2 weeks, you know, for those 2 extra weeks. And if they don't use it, then they lose it. Mm. Well, they roll some over now. But at 5 weeks, we're budgeting for that one. In 5 weeks, 5 years, you can only buy out 1 week. So we're putting extra week.
All right.
At 8 years, you can buy out 2 weeks.
Okay.
At 10 years, you can buy out 3. So we're taking their weekly salary times how many years and budgeting in accordingly.
Okay. All right. I think I understand that. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Are people who get main PERS eligible to also collect Social Security federal?
Yes, because we have an agreement with the IRS. We've been at, I can't remember what it's called.
That's okay.
We are both deducting Social Security and retirement contributions from everybody's paycheck. So yes, they can collect both when they're done. The Social Security benefit will be adjusted based on what their pension will be.
So there is an adjustment?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
That's what I was afraid of.
Okay. So that was longevity. And the main PERS, that got lowered because not everybody signed up for it.
Right.
Right?
Yes. Last year, we budgeted for everybody that was eligible to be able to have it. And there are some people that feel that they are too close to not have the vested time in before they leave the town, that they opted to not join.
Involve themselves.
So it's always voluntary?
Yes. And
well,
that's it.
Yeah. You get one time to choose. When you're first hired, well, when we first joined the group, you can say, yes, I'd like to join.
Never again.
Or no. Okay. After that, you can't change, as long as you work for the town of Acton, the main retirement system says you've already made your decision.
Gotcha.
When you're first hired, you can make that decision, and that's all you get.
Momentous decision.
Yes, yeah. You have to make that right up front.
Okay.
Down to municipal management legal expenses, I think we took a $2,000 decrease, and that was just based on what we saw the last few years and trying to utilize May Municipal more. And only, reaching out to the other attorneys with specific areas that we needed.
I wanted to ask you guys about the drug testing. How often does either one of them go in, or are they picked randomly?
Well, we're going to talk about the drug testing policy, not individuals. So we have a drug testing policy and a company called LexisNexis that runs it. Essentially, so all the employees that drive CDLs have signed copies every year of the drug testing policy, and it is random. LexisNexis notifies me that Johnny got pulled, and based on a board agreement, I follow it from there.
Now, does fire and rescue fall underneath that also?
No, they do not.
Okay.
Right now, it's only road that drive CDL.
Because I know, well, some of them have to have CDLs, don't they?
But they're exempt.
Fire department is not required to have CDL.
Right. So quarterly are when they are chosen, mm-hmm. but they also scatter the quarterly each year. So, and we have 90 days to test them from when they're pulled. So certainly we,
it's better than
mix it up.
Better yeah. than where my husband works.
Are they changing their criteria because of the new legalization of marijuana?
Not as far as I know.
Okay.
Still can't drive a truck if you've...
Still can't drive a CDL.
Yeah, because federally, that's still against the law.
Right.
Yep.
It's just the state of Maine that's adopted it.
Yeah. I mean, alcohol's legal. But you can't drive drunk, so...
Right.
Same thing.
All right. Go down to... I wanted to ask you, Michelle, actually. So the... because I think this was after the phone call we got. The deed transfers, do we want to still stick with that decrease? Didn't they... the message that Mayo left us, I mean, that was changing the form, but I thought there was some talk about that going up.
No.
The fee going up?
Currently, we're allowed a certain... The deed transfers now, they don't send them in the mail like they used to. So when... I'm going to use Jim as an example because he's a realtor. When Jim sells a house to Lois...
Oh, hi, Jim.
There's a deed created that goes through the Registry of Deeds. They send us a copy of that deed.
Right.
And in the past, every deed that they sent us, they charged us a fee for. Well, now we can go online, we can print that deed, and we can print up to a certain amount every year for free.
Oh, so we're not paying any filing of deeds out of this?
No.
Oh, okay, never mind. Scratch
this is
that.
Just
yep.
the transfers.
Okay.
You have a number of how many they let you go in and take, or no?
Well, we just keep creating new usernames. I mean, you can get as many as you
want.
They
just created a new system, and I believe the number has changed, and I'm not sure what that is, because... Yeah. Until last week, I didn't know they created a new system.
Well, and they tell us.
And
no, no, they tell us to create a new. That's what it happens, you know. Some of them. So if you print too many off your current name, then we move that to a list we call read only. So when Dr. Williams comes in and wants to see something, we can pull it up on the registry.
Yeah.
So we have we're maintaining a list of read only and which ones have prints left in them.
Okay. Thank you.
It's nice that you can go online and get them, but who notifies you that a transfer has taken place?
Well, we do them every month regardless. So the assessor comes in the second Wednesday of every month. So for May, when he comes in, all of the April transfers will be printed for him and waiting. So it's something that we automatically do the first day of the month for him.
You have, there's a list of the transfers that are
Yes, you can go in
place.
And choose by town, by, yes.
Okay.
So we pick them all.
Next question is, can anybody get a copy of that transfer or?
Yep.
Public?
Yes.
Okay. You just have to create an account on the Registry of Deeds website.
Yep.
County website.
Yep.
Okay.
Let me know, we can send you a link because they did just change it.
Thank you.
I'd like
we also have deeds here, so if it's something you're looking for,
well,
we may have a copy.
Yeah, I know they're here, some of them, but.
All right, contract deputy, Michelle.
Contract deputy, we see an increase of about $600. That's through collective bargaining with the York County Fire Department, York County Sheriff's Department and their employees that affects our rates.
Trio $100 increase.
That's not bad.
No, that's, they've been minimal, so. Liability insurance.
We took on some new things this year.
A few extra things to insure.
Of course, we have a brand new sand and salt building that is now being insured, as opposed to the old one that wasn't. We have taken on an ambulance, and some tax-acquired property. And so that accounts for what we, because the all these things happened after we paid the bill, we weren't charged for them this year. And that's an estimate as to what it's going to increase our bill for next year.
Gotcha. Now, is that tax property, is that public property that you've actually collected because of lack of taxes?
Yes.
Yes.
We've gone through the foreclosure process.
Are you planning on having
a tax sale?
An auction?
The only one that we have at this point, sorry, that it looks like we're going to be able to sell it back to the original owner.
And I was there for Tuesday, and I understand.
Yeah, so, you know, it's up to the selectmen. They can certainly come to us anytime and say, we'd like to reevaluate the list of Town of Acton property, and then they can decide what they, you know, wanted to do or if they decided they wanted to have a sale.
Because I know a few years ago, it was so many years you had to do it. It wasn't a choice.
No, the town can, I mean, it comes off the tax roll. It's up to the selectmen to decide what they want to do with it, so. We try not to keep properties that have houses on it. That's why we're moving so quickly with this one. Mm-hmm. But the land is a decision the board can make.
Okay. Thank you.
All right. I'll let you talk about the loans there.
Okay. We have two loans that are expiring this year.
Woohoo!
A happy day. So the first one being the loan for $25,000 that was taken out 5 years ago for some maintenance to the windows and the sills and whatnot.
Here in this building?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
And the fire truck that we bought 5 years ago, forgive me, I can't remember which truck it is.
Engine 2.
We have a half a year's payment left on that. So
that's great.
There's the decrease there.
That went by quick.
You'll see the Goat Hill loan. Of course, we're not there yet this year. So that money won't be expended.
How is that project coming along at this point?
It's moving along. At this point, we're at the mercy of Three Rivers. Everything's good on our side, so we're just waiting.
Yeah. And we do have a bid out for that loan because things are moving along. And that is the high. The 17,522 is the high that the town voted on. So it's the highest rate that the town agreed that we would pay, and the highest yearly rate that the town agreed we would pay when we voted on that purchase.
Yeah, I know there was a time limit. That's what I was wondering.
Yeah, June 30th, yeah. They have to sign.
So certainly that number might be lower when it comes down to what's said and done. Our loan bid is due next week, so we really won't have those numbers until next week, the final numbers. There's a little bit. We dropped in abatements a little bit just because we have a good system going on now. The assessor is pretty on top of things, so we have to leave something there. When you're talking poverty abatements and fires and stuff like that happen throughout the year. But we did drop it down a little bit.
And the mileage just...
The mileage moved with the office manager's salary.
Any questions? We're doing good. The next section is the elections. As you'll see, everything stays flat. Everything stayed there, stayed flatline. I've kept it that way since 2015. We haven't had any problems since then. Hoping maybe next year we can get a little more stability and might be able to lower it a little bit now that we're using the machine more consistently and we know exactly what the state's going to charge us for programming local elections. That was one of the pieces that we were waiting for because the state pays to program any state ballot. But in June, for example, so you've got a state ballot and you're going to have a town ballot, there's a third company that has to program this ballot and make it, you know, so it can go through the machine, and that's a town cost. We have the option of hand counting one and letting the machine count the other. I just assume everything go in the machine and it'd be the same, so.
On an average, how many do you have to be here to make efficiency? In other words, how many clerks do you actually have to have?
Well, we have, I mean, we always have to have, well, I shouldn't say always, depending on the type of election, we have to have party lines. I mean, at the end of the evening, if we're not hand counting anything and it's all by machine, we in the past have had just a Republican and a Democrat. They may have to hand count one lot. There's always there's a chance that some voters want their ballot hand counted, so we have to allow for that. But I mean, I can remember some of my first elections here. One of the first ones, it was back in 2006. We had someone from, do you remember Sheila Parks?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
You know that name?
Yes.
How?
It's because I remember.
So this woman, Sheila Parks, came down from New York City, I think it was?
Uh-huh.
New York City, yes. Do you remember her?
Yeah.
And she just was, I mean, we counted the presidential, and I think we got finished by, I don't know, 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning. I mean, the whole country knew who had won, and here we were still hand counting. And we had probably 15 or 20 teams, but I was new. I was my first year in Acton, and we counted everything twice. I mean, everything proved. There was no, you know what I mean? Very efficient. She came down and watched the whole process and was so pleased with Acton, she wrote a story on it in the Boston Globe. She's actually, I meant to tell you, Jim, I don't know if I did, she's still doing that kind of stuff. She reached out to me.
She travels all over the country.
Yeah, she wants me to travel with her as
there you go.
Wants me to travel with her as a spokesperson, but she reached out to me about 3 months ago. She wants to come back. So
yeah, she's a very nice woman.
I've never met her. Actually, I have met her, but it's been a long time. But anyway, so there's a little wiggle room in there. You never know, just like snowstorms, how many special town meetings or how many elections we might have or need. So,
I just wonder if you kept a basic list, if it's 5 or 25, you know what I'm saying?
What do you mean? Five? I guess
I mean, in other words, if you have 5 people that you rely on that has to be there.
Well, during the day, I mean, is where your staff comes from. I mean, during the day, you have to have, you figure 2, 4, 6. I probably have 7 people working in each shift. So, you know, plus you've got to have your moderators. Yeah.
Okay. That way just gives us a ballpark.
Let's see. Next is the registrar salary. It's required by the state. That's the person that, the registrar that oversees the CVR, the computer voter list. So there's no changes there. And then Michelle.
Finance. There's a salary increase there, which then affects Social Security and Medicare.
About what percentage is that?
Well, what percentage increase?
Yes.
Okay, actually, if you can, this is a good time to talk about it. Inside your books.
No, I haven't handed those out.
Oh, you haven't handed them out. I had one in my book.
Well, because I need your book yesterday.
I'm special. Say that again, Lois.
I said you were special.
So,
thank you, ma'am.
And this is all driven by the board, but you know, Michelle and I like to talk, and they'll jump in and cut us off anytime they're ready. What you're getting now is the current department heads, what their current wage is, hourly wage, whether they work 10 hours, 30 hours, 40 hours, and what the board's proposing the hourly wage is.
Thank you, Mr. Remedy.
You're welcome, Mr.
Driscoll. Ed, you want to go over that?
I can attempt to. There's an easy bottom line to it, and I'm going to use both the salary for the director of finance and the town administrator. Both of those two positions, really, over the past 5 to 8 years probably, have gotten the cost of living raises like all the other departments have. The one thing that hasn't happened is there hasn't been a merit raise. And part of that is the other departments, some of them are new. For instance, the fire chief's position. He came in at a current rate of what a fire chief would be. These other two positions, two positions we've had for a long time, I guess what I'm getting at is we really haven't kept up with the increase of what those salaries should be.
Mm.
So, yes, you look at it and it looks like a huge jump, but what it is we're playing catch up. which we are doing on some of these other, you know, we've seen throughout the morning. Those two positions, for instance, you know, like I say, we're playing catch up on them. The town administrator is a new position we created a year ago, a year and a half ago.
About a year.
Yeah, about a year ago. And in doing that, we basically we combined three or four different positions, three or four different titles that that individual had been doing, brought it under one umbrella. So rather than having three or four different pay lines, we've kind of grouped them together and said, okay, you're doing this, 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 and this. Why don't we just make it one position with one salary? And it's actually worked out better to track and to keep track of what gets done. So, like I said, I'm grouping both of those together, even though we are on the finance side.
I think that's clear at the town meeting, too.
Yeah.
It's about time that happened. Yeah.
The amount of responsibilities and duties in that town administrator, it's a steal.
Mm-hmm.
$36 an hour.
Yeah.
I'd like to say that what's good about seeing this is, and maybe a sensitive subject, but it's nationwide. And it's the disparity between what men make nationwide, and this is a fact, this isn't me talking, compared to women. And if you compare the fire chief and Kenny, and I have a great deal of respect for Kenny, do a wonderful job down there, with what Jennifer does here, her responsibilities, and Michelle's, it's nice, from my perspective, to see the window finally closing here in Acton. You know what I mean? And I think there's something to that, you know? But do I think they're worth it? Absolutely. And I think it's a deal at the hourly rate that you have down there, you know.
About a year and a half ago, we did change the code enforcement's rate. You know, we changed him to director of planning and land use. So we gave him a new title that went along more with what he was doing. You know, he was working more with the planning board, working more with, you know, with the other entities. So we changed that. And we changed his rate of pay a few years ago, year and a half or so ago. So now the next step was to look at all of them. And really what really brought it on was the fire chief's position. We looked at that and said, wow, you know, you're right. This is out of whack. Mm-hmm. So thusly raising these other positions, changing the titles around a little bit to more explain what they do and then bring the rate up accordingly. So
I think it's important, too, to know if you don't already, and you may, departments like the code enforcement, even APAT and fire chief, actually some with the road commissioner, we handle a lot of stuff for them. We do, obviously, she does all of their payroll. We do all of their claims, whether they be workers' comp claims. We do all of their ordering, not necessarily road commissioners, but every, you know, ordering as far as, you know, whether it be a Staples order or Michael needs a new camera for APAT. I mean, all the not all, but we do a good portion of their administrative work to help help out. So
I have a question, and then I have a comment or an observation or a suggestion. The election clerk salary, that's included. Who's doing the election clerk? Or
the election clerk are the staff that I actually bring in, the Republicans and Democrats that work here that day.
Oh, okay. All right. Okay. Yes. Thank you. All right. That was the question. Now, the observation and recommendation I would like to make is that you take this salary list and offer it to the town meeting for an up or down vote. I think you'll get the support of this board, definitely, and it will clarify a lot of issues that are circulating around town in discussion. I don't think there's any question that it's justifiable, and I think that there will not be an issue, but there is and has been an ongoing issue with respect to how all these various jobs are getting paid for, and specifically some of that comment obviously has been addressed to you, you know, or about you, okay? And all I'm suggesting is that just like we do for the road commissioners, we say, here, town, this is it, and this is what Jennifer's making an hour.
Well, this is what the position's making. I mean, it's
right, okay, right. I understand that. But this is what the position is worth. It's justifiable. And all the other little bits and pieces are gone. All right? Suggestion. Okay? And I think it'll fly without any question at all.
I have one other question, if I may. I think that as far as the salaries are concerned, it's certainly justifiable, number one. Number two, if you had taken basic salaries the basic minimum wage back in 1970. And if we had continued to, with inflation, increase it as far as buying power, the minimum wage in the U.S. today would be $47 an hour. So this is certainly not an outrageous figure. And in fact, it may very well be that all of this terrible turnover of people is going to perhaps be more or less frozen if, in fact, now people are getting what they're supposed to be getting as far as comparable wages elsewhere around the year. So I'm entirely in favor of it, and I don't know how you want to present that to the voters. It may be that they will say yes to it. Certainly they should, because
I think they will. I don't think there's any question.
I hope so.
My only concern with that is you're talking about proposed wages for one particular individual, okay? If she leaves and you get a new town administrator, she hasn't been here for 13 years. Same way with code enforcement, etc. You can't say the town administrator's salary or hourly pay is this. It's
right.
Based upon the number of years they've
been here. Because
if someone left,
you would have that line mixed into general government, and he's right. You wouldn't have to offer them that full amount.
Right.
Itemize it like that, yeah. You would.
I mean, it's something that has to be brought forward, you know, so that everybody understands.
Right.
Somebody else comes in. We're not going to give them that amount of money.
Up to might solve it.
Yeah.
Well, I have one question. Is this something you guys look at nationally or locally? How does this actually come to play with figures?
Locally and statewide.
Right.
Okay. I just didn't know. I don't want to know where you got your figures.
I was going to say that if we did have to bring somebody in new, and well, I won't wonder.
Go ahead, Tom.
I think we're going to have to pay that anyway. I mean, that's what this is reflecting. This is reflecting probably less than what most qualified people out there are getting. It's an increase, and it should be. But I don't have any problem voting on the floor and offering to pay that and get somebody who's qualified for the job. Sure, you can get somebody.
Mr. Walsh.
Depend on your selectmen to make a educated choice.
Yeah.
Is it possible in presenting this to the voters that we give a little summary of what the towns around us are paying, both on the New Hampshire side as well as on the Maine side, so that they will realize that we have been lowballing it for a long time and now we're up to par with our competing towns?
You can, and there's a Maine Municipal Survey that certainly all of you can look at, but anybody that's looked at that over the years, it is not an easy document to look at, and the reason is that, you know, they're going to have a secretary, let's say. You know, you might have a secretary, you might have an executive secretary, you might have a town administrator, all basically are doing secretarial work. But they all have different added duties, so it's hard to come up with their hourly rates. I mean, it's different to say, you know, an election clerk. We can certainly show you that. But unless you look at all of the hourly rates and look at all the added duties, it's going to be hard to compare. But
well, if you have towns around here that have the same job description type things, you know, just to show us that, in fact, this is not an outlandish.
That's where part
request.
Of the problem is trying to come up with like kind job descriptions.
I understand.
Some towns, look, the position that Jennifer is in as a town administrator now, before it was we had it broken down to about four different places, other towns may have three different people doing that job, either part-time or full-time. Which
and
means
that one paper that you made showing how many people
right.
are doing the job of what you have done.
Right, which means
the best
have,
thing to show.
I think that's what Will's saying.
Right.
You can find that right online, Will.
And she has it actually. Yeah. All the towns around here, there are four or five people in that office and
right.
elsewhere.
Right.
Okay.
And that's a great question, what he's
yeah.
saying. You can do that and it will
we'll work on some documentation first around
deal.
Yeah,
because yeah, you definitely want to show the
because the things you're going to be saving is that with the health insurance,
yeah,
the vacation time.
Oh, the benefits, and that's 25% increase
yeah. so
this year with
you know,
the school board.
Yeah, like you said, there's 25% right there. That's a savings times three,
yep.
three people.
The fact
yeah.
is,
so,
we've been treating our people like they're all part time for years and years and years.
Yeah,
right,
exactly.
Right,
and,
right.
I can't tell you the last time we worked
assuming
part-time.
Their neighbors, et cetera. Right, and we haven't made that transition to realizing that
right.
the expectation is higher on the public.
I mean. Just to split the group a little bit, you as warrant and finance members know
when you have a question, you go to Jennifer, mm-hmm. or you go to the town administrator.
I find it.
Yeah, but then she sends it out to three or four different places, and it all groups back in again and comes back again.
Right. Hmm.
Well, there's 20 minutes of a day right there.
Right, exactly.
So,
no question.
Yeah, mm-hmm. and you figure that times every department in town,
mm-hmm.
us, Parks and Recs, I mean, they're out a little bit, but Parks and Recs, Fire Department, Transfer Station.
Roads.
Yeah, both sides of the roads. I mean, you know. I wonder why she even has time to do her own job sometimes.
So efficiently right now.
Yes, yes.
Well, it's run the best for
right.
a long time.
So what we need to do is get the rate of pay where it needs to be.
Right.
So.
And I think it would be well worth your while to put it before the town meeting and let everybody know what's going on.
You balance out every year
yeah.
to the penny, and it's actuals. That's huge. Yeah. You balance out day to day.
Yeah,
that's unbelievable. So the numbers we're seeing, we're getting, it's real numbers.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the resources that this town offers, I deal with them all as a real estate agent. It's not even close. You know, for one time there was talk about a town manager, and I was one of the ones at the time when Tom and I butted heads about
that.
He was against it. But I would just suggest anything even close.
No,
I
don't think we need anything like that. No.
It's fantastic.
Yep. Okay.
Going on.
Continue on.
Okay. So for the rest of the finance, the only significant other significant increases there are Social Security and Medicare due to the salary change. Training I dropped down a little bit just because we run on a 5-year cycle with the programs. And there's only a few that I need to take within this next year to keep on my 5-year cycle for certification. Overall for the department is $7,452 increase. The next line on the next page is town administrator. This is where the office manager salary went, and it's combined with the town clerk's tax and tax collector salary. Everything was kind of spread out before, and we were taking salary pieces from here, there, and everywhere. Just like we did with the land use, we've combined everything that had to do with the administrator and the town clerk into one department so that it makes it easier for me paying the bills. It makes it easy for the person who's requesting the bills to be paid, and it makes it easier to follow. Okay, the town administrator, you know who's in charge of that line. If you have a question about that line, where do you go?
My only question on that is,
I have a question.
My only question on that is that why do we have that figure in there for fiscal year 2015? There was no position by that name.
It was just the town clerk's line then.
Yeah, but something's, what am I missing here? Something, because it's not going from $29.49 an hour to $36.05 an hour isn't a $36,000 increase. So the FY17 budget, that $38.9, what is that?
$38.9 is the town clerk tax collector salary.
Okay, so then we would need to add the office manager salary from last year.
Right, so those things I didn't carry
right,
over.
Right, okay. Well, just I just don't want them looking at that increase-decrease
yeah.
line and seeing 36,000.
Yeah, those things were all left
have it,
in the original
all right.
line.
And the fact that we didn't have a town administrator in fiscal year 15 or 16.
Right. We
that
had
should be
office.
Very confusing.
Yeah.
So technically, that number, that 38,920, you need to add 22,412. So that brings you to a salary of 61,332. So you come that number then with the 18, so that decrease number looks a lot, it doesn't look as bad. So does everybody follow what I'm saying? The office manager, what number wasn't brought over?
Yep.
So it's not a $36,000 increase.
It's important to do.
Very important.
You'd really take 22 off of that number.
Yeah.
Right.
Well, you would add 22 to the 38,000.
Right.
Right.
Right. When you add it there, you got to take it off. Yeah, let's take it off the 36.
Right.
The 36 would actually be down.
Somewhere. Right. Either way.
Yeah.
Right. I took the 61.
Right. Yeah.
Subtracted 74.
Yeah.
Right.
Yep.
One question or comment.
Go ahead.
We have statutory officers of the town, treasurer and town clerk, etc. here, how are we identifying them officially? We need some way, some mechanism to establish what your authorities are and what your responsibilities, legal responsibilities are.
The town.
Well, we do have that through appointments.
Right, and those are still happening.
Right, okay. So.
I mean, the town administrator and the town clerk are the same person. They're getting, the town clerk and tax collector are still being sworn in separately.
You as municipal clerk have certain statutory duties.
Correct.
Okay, and how is that made clear to the public? That's the only concern I have here. Somewhere there has to be a notice, and this may be included when we talk about what's happening here, but some notice that you retain the duties of municipal clerk, and you retain the duties and responsibilities of municipal treasurer. And we may do that if this other thing does go to the floor, but it should be in there somewhere.
Yeah, it may seem like stating the obvious, but I think it's...
If it's on paper, it's, you know...
Yeah. No, and we, I mean, in the description, I mean, I was under the impression, and I could be wrong, to the board, I mean, I knew they were combining all this into one town administrator line, but as far as the title, if somebody asked me what I do for the town of Acton, as far as I'm concerned, I'm the town administrator, town clerk, and tax collector.
Right, but that has to be public.
Absolutely. It all needs to be part of the title, because those are authoritative, authoritative positions that need to be sworn in, and...
Right.
So, you're right.
And you have statutory responsibilities.
Right, which I follow.
Which I'm gonna... We know that, Jennifer. Sometimes to her... Well, I won't speak.
Yeah. Good time for you to take a break.
Yep.
All right, so where are we at? So that brings us down to the assessment subcontractor and the assessing contracted software. That's our projects with O'Donnell's, and that's our assessing, and that's everything that we see online. Before Lois asks, so that number stayed the same because we actually got three free layers coming up on People GIS, so that's where that's going to be one of them.
That's what I was wondering.
Wanted to be a surprise for you. You're getting three layers. I've got one for you, and I think we're going to do one for dogs. I haven't decided what to do with the last one. But. And then land use, we did.
Good.
Happy day.
Happy. That's it.
There are some miscellaneous things that... We might want to discuss as far as projects under your miscellaneous tabs.
Which number?
Miscellaneous.
The front of the
red.
Little green tab.
Red. Big red.
It's different than everybody else. I had to keep
one. Second one from the last.
There you go. Turn.
Okay.
Oh, I see. I got it.
No. 103.
My miscellaneous.
There.
What?
There.
Where do you find it?
Yep.
Okay.
We're all on miscellaneous.
Good.
The emergency fund, that's kind of like a contingency for the town that comes out of the undesignated fund should an emergency or an unexpected expense come up during the year.
Miscellaneous?
Staying the same. The projects this year that we're looking at so far, there's three doors that need replacing on the town hall.
They're different colors.
We've got a quote. Four doors?
One, two, three, and Kenny's downstairs.
Okay, so four doors.
Four doors.
And then town hall siding, the whole backside is all that's left to do.
Yeah, I was going to ask.
But didn't we decide we were doing that in two, or did we budget it for one? I think that was, where's your number? What number are we looking
30?
At? Yeah, that's one.
Okay.
That's breaking it up into two. We're still going to have one more year of that.
Yep.
Of what?
The siding.
And what about the ramp out front? This one.
The ramp out front. We are hoping to get some prices from the same individual that did the library and see if he can bring it together. It's not something that the board has kind of, you know, said go out and get one yet. We're going to see how the numbers go. Right now, the budget is up overall, even with, you know, putting forward the Board of Selectmen's numbers and, you know, not the original fire chiefs or not the original APATs or, it's still up. How much? $100,000?
Yes.
So.
How many?
Was it 182?
182 is the total.
Yeah,
182 for assessment.
So. With the board cuts, we're still up 182. So some, we did leave out some projects like that one.
And roughly, what did it cost us to do that side?
To do the library, we spent just the stonework.
Yeah.
About $5,000-$6,000. Not the door, not the siding, not the window.
The door was what, $3,500?
The reason I was asking, because I happened to look at the ramp and it was in.
Yeah, there's a hole in it. That ramp was put in 2006, and we actually got it back. We got the money back, so we've, from the state, when we became wheelchair accessible, so we've gotten our life out of that ramp.
Oh, yeah.
Tom?
I'm going to go, you know where I'm going with this issue. First of all, what part of the town hall has to be done? The new part back there, right?
The back of the whole, of all of them.
Okay. I guess I'm going to raise the question, why are we bothering with this, okay? And the building is functionally obsolete, burned down any time. This doesn't work. And not only that, it potentially is doing damage to the new building. I think it's time that we think about doing something about this facility. And
you're going to have a fight on your hands, I'm telling you right now.
I understand that, but the reality is.
And it's mostly my aging up, you're going to get it.
Okay, I'm bringing it up again.
You've been around longer than probably most of the buildings.
Okay, I'm bringing it up. If we want to repair it, it's doable. It only will cost about 3 to 4 times as much as it would to start from scratch. And I know it's.
I got to get it. And now they've got a new rule, too, about tearing down historical buildings.
It's working right now. We don't have the million-plus dollars.
That's it.
To build a new building.
Well.
You know?
No, but it's.
And then where would you put it? Because like Lois says, I don't think there's anybody in town that's lived here any length of time.
I'm going to have your.
That's going to want to see any of these buildings torn down.
As it was when they got connected, there was a heck of a fight when they all got connected. I was here during that battle of the worlds.
Stop thinking ahead, Tom.
But this isn't going to holistically heal.
No, but it's not.
You're going to have a fight.
I'm just bringing the issue up because I think we need to start thinking about it.
It's stable at the moment, so.
I agree.
You know, we've got 3/4 of the house painted. We need to finish painting the rest, so.
There will be a battle.
Thank you, Tom.
Yes, not to top it all.
All right, let's finish off this miscellaneous list.
A bicentennial's coming up soon, too. So that's what I'm saying. The bicentennial to the town's coming up soon, too.
So we should keep our sacred little room here
for
the bicentennial.
You're sitting over the three-holer, Bill.
Let's move on. Yeah.
Four-holer, Tom.
The next thing on our list is a contract deputy vehicle. And that's a half a cost. It's an SUV rather than the little car that gets sent down all these little dirt roads that we hope that it makes it back out. But the Sheriff's Department has notified the town that it is coming due to be replaced. He's had several issues this year with that car.
Where is that?
And
probably miscellaneous.
Running that little car on a lot of these roads, doing camp checks and whatnot.
First page.
Is not ideal.
Now, Shapley,
the town of Shapley is putting a warrant article through with their school budget.
For the same amount?
For the same amount, for half.
Would this be a time to bring up the other subject that we talked about? Yeah, I'm going to bring it up anyway.
Too late now.
Yeah, they've already opened the door. Just an FYI, and this is nothing for this year, but just something to think about. We were approached by the Sheriff's Department. They would, in the fact that they may want to add, or if they're looking to possibly add another sheriff and bringing in the town of Newfield. So it's just in the talking phase right now, to where you'd have two sheriffs doing three towns as contract deputy. So it's just something that's out there, something that's, you know, been talked about. Like I say, it's an FYI, just for a down-the-road type thing. We did, Elise and I attended a meeting, two or three weeks ago? Yeah, met with the Sheriff's Department and the town of Shapley, the town of Newfield representatives. And it's nothing that's going to be grant-worthy, but it's just something they're looking to possibly do if the town of Newfield is interested and the other two towns are interested. So
will it mean a decrease as far as each?
No, it'll end up being an increase.
Because we're adding another position.
Because you're adding another position, but there'd be two sheriffs,
two cars
split three ways.
The only thing is, it's such a large area.
So, well, that's...
And they're going to come too. It's not in this year's budget,
Yeah, it's not in this year's budget. I'm just throwing it out there because it's something that, that you folks ought to be aware of, and just have it out there in your minds, you know. I don't know whether we're going to do it or not. It's just...
I even know cruising through Acton.
Yeah, it's worth exploring. It's just in the explorer phase, so.
Yeah.
Why we were talking about sheriff's cars and whatnot, so. Okay, sorry.
So where do we go from here with the, Ed, with the both committees? What do you want to do?
Well...
It's a pleasure.
I think we need to, as the Board of Selectmen, we need to go back and kind of look at where we, where our proposals were. I don't know if there's anything you see in there you want to change, but, I see a couple things in there I'd like to revisit,
okay,
you know, that we had talked about cutting.
We can schedule a meeting for that.
Yeah.
What about?
The Board of, you know, Warrant and Finance, you probably have some more questions for some of the people that showed up today.
Actually, I don't particularly, but I don't know other committee members may.
Tom, you must have some.
I think we have, we should have a meeting, a scheduler for ourselves, a meeting with the road commissioners.
Yeah, we owe it to the road.
We should also schedule a meeting with the fire department.
Just a breakdown, Tom?
Just what?
A breakdown of some of the...
Yeah.
Well, a breakdown of some of the information, some explanations, some longer-term planning. I have, and Ed's familiar, well, all you guys are familiar with this. I've had problems with this planning process at the fire department for a long time because there was no plan. We need some idea of where we're going because I can see this thing turning into $1 million-a-year operation without any difficulty.
I think that's why the selectmen cut that position out right off. They felt like it hadn't been a year up and running.
Right.
They were hired as a working chief, and that's what they wanted to see. So,
so I
they
think
did
we,
cut that.
I think for our benefit, we need to be thinking a little bit longer term. And as I, and I'll tell the selectmen what I said the other day when we were talking about this warrant and finance, the scenario over there is different from what it used to be. The people who submitted the budget were citizens of the town. They were our neighbors and our friends, and they were conscious of the tax implications of what they were submitting. Now we have professional staff who's doing his job, and I don't have a problem with that, and I think that's fine. But there isn't the restraint there that there would be if all these submitted budgets were going before the full fire department and being discussed in an open meeting of the fire department and the town, and the fire department was voting on it as it used to before it came to warrant and finance. So I think our load, our lift here is a little bit heavier than it has been in the past. We've got to assume
I would totally agree with that, but my only comment about the fire department is, and I have problems with the new ambulance, we can talk about that as well if the committee desires, but the fact is that as they increase the capability of their medical rescue by having more and more medics, you will be hopefully surprised when you start getting large amounts of dollars back, more than what we've ever had before, in compensation from insurance companies and the federal government, from Medicare and Medicaid, because having a medic on board really brings in the dollars.
I understand
and
that.
And we don't have enough data yet because they've just started this program. So it looks like they're really spending a lot of money, but to take their part for a second, we don't have enough database right now to see how much more they're going to be actually making in profit.
Right. I understand that. And I think that's part of the long-term view. But the other thing that concerns me here is I think our rescue portion of the fire department over there is probably the most important to the citizens of Acton.
Average age is 85 here.
Right, and it's going to grow because our access to hospitals is further away. There's a serious question in my mind with whether we need the firefighting capability that we have over there or are thinking about having in the future. Okay, so I think there's an opportunity to move the emphasis to what's most important to the citizens of Acton. Not saying the fire department isn't, but
a plan, like you said.
A plan. I mean, we need to think ahead of where we're going here. Okay.
You've got that. I mean, you can't do one without the other, really. You can't do one without the other.
Well, I don't disagree. I'm not saying they should.
The rescue is actually what helps fund the fire department now.
Right.
So, and that's the direction it's in.
Right.
So.
And that's fine.
Yeah.
That's fine. But I think maybe we need to be thinking a little bit of a shift of focus here. away from the big red trucks.
Well, I think that's already started, and I think this chief is personifying that. The other thing is, if you want to look way out in the future, and that is helicopter, okay? And that going perhaps to Rochester now, rather than the huge circuitous route that we have to go to Maine Medical Center in Portland.
Well, there's a lot to think about here.
And yep.
Yeah, I think it's time that we had something. And that's things you guys, you folks can bring up at the Warrant and Finance meeting,
right,
too.
Right.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So I don't know if we need to go any further with that discussion here, you know, today.
I would just wish that the selectmen would let us know about raising versus cutting various suggested monies, for example, for the donations. Would you give us some guidelines on that, please?
You haven't discussed any of that right now.
If we recommend increasing some and decreasing others, can we do that and have it go back to you for reconsideration?
Yeah, I mean, the one time that they talked about it, one of the things they said was that they were, whatever the social service request was, they were going to move that forward. They weren't going to take it upon themselves to cut it. They were going to let the voters decide, and they were going to have them all in individual warrant articles this year. So if Red Cross, for example, asked for $1,000, you guys can make any recommendation of $1,000 or less, but
not to add it.
We can't add to. I mean, that's their request. We're not going to give them more than they've asked for. If they feel confident with $1,000, then you can recommend up to $1,000. You can make any recommendation below it. We took care of the two that we thought inadvertently requested $500.
That's
correct. Both corrected letters.
That's correct. And we saw those.
Well, he knows that. He knows that they got new letters. They both say $1,000 now, so there shouldn't be anywhere you want to increase, right?
No.
I don't think so, but I just wanted to make sure that you clarified for our committee what the rules are as far as that's concerned.
Any warrant article can only be decreased.
You can only decrease. Yeah.
Well, that assumes that the figure is in the article itself.
And it will be.
Okay. Well, that's up to you guys to decide.
Right.
Traditionally in town it was not up until the early 1990s, but we'll leave that.
They're going to be all individual right in the article.
The warrant's going to be a hell of a lot longer.
Yes.
Yeah.
Especially being as you've got 15 entities that have asked for donations.
But it's going to be a lot clearer, I think.
Yeah. Yeah. But there's going to be 15.
No, it's going to be transparent.
Exactly, Jim.
Yep.
Because the paper that I just handed you out, of course, there's going to be a warrant article about ratification of overdraft of winter funds. So that's where we're at now. We're still under the 15% allowed by law, so we don't need a special town meeting. We're close. Like, if we had some ice tonight, we would be having a town meeting next week. But we are still within that 15%. Okay. So
good.
Can I just make one more suggestion? When you put together those funds to be raised for the social services, that you phrase it to see if the town will appropriate the request and include in the article that this is the requested amount. Okay? In other words, appropriate the amount requested by blah, 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 and put the number in.
Yep.
That way it's clear to everybody where that number comes from.
Right.
Okay?
Good.
Thank you.
Anything else anybody has?
No, sir. No.
We should keep going. The sun's not out.
This has been one of the most productive.
Yeah. It's Earth Day. You should be out picking up trash.
Yeah.
I'm going to.
It's been one of the most productive meetings I think we've ever had as a group. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much for your time.
Night, all.
Night. Yeah.